2015, Patna Women's College went in for the third cycle of accreditation and received an A grade with a high CGPA, that is 3.58 out of 4. The University Grants Commission conferred autonomous status to Patna Women's College on 2nd January 2018, and thereafter Patna University notified the same on 18th July 2018. NAC recognized Patna Women's College as one of the highly performing colleges in the country and extended the accreditation period from 5 years to 7 years. The college has been granted Star College Scheme by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, to enhance conceptual clarity, development of scientific thinking and creativity amongst students. Patna Women's College was selected for the Development of Career Hub by RUSA and MHRD. Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, carried out the digital launch and inaugurated the hub at Patna Women's College on 3rd February 2019. With year-to-year smiles and pride in our hearts, around 840 students of 2015-2018 session of Patna Women's College, Patna, received their degrees at its first convocation organized on the college campus on 2nd September 2019. Patna Women's College has been recognized to establish Institutions Innovation Council under the aegis of MHRD's Innovation Council, Government of India, on 11th September 2019. Our endeavor continues to be one of quality, sustenance and excellence in all fields. Patna Women's College, the first college for women in Bihar, is a religious minority institution run by the Catholic Sisters of the Apostolic Carmel. It was founded by Bishop B.J. Sullivan S.J., Bishop of Patna, and Mother M. Josephine A.C. in the year 1940. Principles down the years. Institution trains young women not just academically but for life. They do not easily make a compromise with their values as they receive holistic education. There are 185 faculty members. The effective functioning of the college is also ensured by 98 administrative, technical and other members of the staff. We at Patna Women's College work with high self-esteem, which motivates, stimulates and mobilizes students and faculty down the road to excellence. Thank you.
A very good morning and a warm welcome to one and all. Once again, I welcome you all. It's a very empowering statement by Sarah Bernhardt. She says, life begets life. Energy creates energy. It is by spending oneself that one becomes rich. And with this nice statement, I welcome you all, respected Dr. Sister M. Rashmi A.C., Principal Patna Women's College, Autonomous, Honorable Professor Amar Aaron Pigga, Director and Professor XISS Ranchi, Honorable Professor Moshmi Datta, Professor and Vice Principal, Nagindas Khandwala College, Autonomous, Mumbai, Honorable Teachers and dearest participants. Myself, Poonam Ibrahim Lakram, Assistant Professor, Department of MCA, Patna Women's College. On behalf of entire college and the entire organizing committee, I welcome you all on 2-day online international conference on COVID-19, pandemic and world tourism, hospitality, trends, challenges, and future prospects. Organized by Internal Quality Assurance Cell, Patna Women's College, Autonomous. To make this day more auspicious, let's begin our day with praying together. Somebody has said, when you kneel down to God, He stands up for you. And when He stands up for you, no one can stand against you. Now, may I request Sister M. Tanisha A.C., Vice Principal, Patna Women's College, to kindly lead us into prayer. Over to you, Sister.
Thank you, Poonam. Before we begin today's task, let us pause for a while to remember the God of the universe, the author of life and beauty, and offer our homage to that divine presence in and around us as we watch a devotional song.
प्रभु तेरा प्यार सादे से भी गहरा, तू है महा आसमानों से भी ऊंचा, तेरे विचार सागर की रेत से ज्यादा, प्रभु राधे सृष्टि से भी है बड़ा,
God, thank you for enabling us to be virtually connected to each other at this international conference. May we approach each other with respect and kindness. Bless the organizers, resource persons, and participants of this event. Lead us, O God, from the sight of the lovely things of the world to the thought of Thee, their Creator, and grant that delighting in the beautiful things of Thy creation, we may delight in Thee, the first author of beauty and the sovereign Lord of all Thy works. God of love, show us our place in this world as channels of your love for all the creatures of this earth, for not one of them is forgotten in your sight. Enlighten those who possess power and money, that they may avoid the sin of indifference, that they may love the common good, advance the weak, and care for this world in which we live. The poor and the earth are crying out. O Lord, seize us with your power and light. Help us to protect all life, to prepare for a better future, for a world of justice, peace, love, and beauty. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you, sister. We now feel more rejuvenated and connected to God. Moving forward, let's begin today's session. May I request Dr. Aparajita Krishna, Head, Department of Physics, Patna Women's College, to kindly take over the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Poonam. Good morning to one and all. It gives us immense pleasure to extend a warm welcome to distinguished keynote speakers, delegates, and academicians to this two-day online international conference on COVID-19 pandemic and world tourism, hospitality, trends, challenges, and future prospects, organized by IQAC of Patna Women's College. Tourism and hospitality sector is a leading global industry and provides wide range of employability. But in the present world scenario of current pandemic and unprecedented lockdown, the entire sector has been subjected to breakdown. In the light of this challenge, it will take much time for tourism industry engine to be restarted. To revive this sector, we need to understand what has changed. We are collectively searching ways to make new normals and grow accordingly to become a global force once again. Amid ongoing uncertainties and challenges, this conference has been organized to offer a common platform for deliberations and discussions to help and understand possibilities post-COVID through a different lens and explore the world with a newfound appreciation. At Patna Women's College, encouragement, enthusiasm, and excellence are few major pillars of strength. Dr. Sister Rashmi AC, principal, is at the helm of affairs and taking the institution forward with her visionary approach. Sister Rashmi, an academician and an able administrator, who is always willing to take challenges and infuse a spirit of belongingness to its team. In the changed academic scenario, she has taken serious relevant issues and conducted series of webinars to reach out to people and society at large. May I have the privilege of inviting Dr. Sister Rashmi AC, Principal, Patna Women's College Autonomous, to deliver the welcome address. Sister.
Thank you, Aprajita. A very good morning and a warm welcome to all of you to this two-day online international conference on COVID-19 pandemic and the world tourism hospitality trends, challenges, and future prospects. I warmly welcome our esteemed resource persons, our distinguished guests, delegates from various states and from various prestigious colleges across the country and abroad. It is great to see all of you here at this platform. The Department of Geography had planned to hold a national seminar on challenges, trends, and future prospects of tourism. The IQSC of the college then took the initiative to conduct the same in a different form and on a different platform. Now, sitting at home from different parts of the country and abroad, we have come together to share our views on this platform. No doubt, we are being together in distances in order to safeguard the other. In January 2020, we never imagined that the world would get into a lockdown, which is still unpredictable. No doubt, it is a time of pause, a time beyond the everydayness. We can see more birds flying around, quieter moments to listen to them singing in our gardens, more time to read, relax with our dear ones at home. One thing is very clear to us, that the virus does not respect human barriers, categories, or power structures. The pandemic, COVID-19, has gripped the world in a manner which no other calamity or crisis has done before. This has impacted the world economy, with the travel and hospitality industry being the worst hit. Travel and tourism is among the most affected sectors, with hotels closed and travel restrictions put in place. Considerable changes remain ahead, challenges remain ahead, starting with the unknown duration of the pandemic and the travel restrictions and the ailing world economy. We see that the countries around the world, no doubt, are implementing a wide range of measures to mitigate the impact of COVID-19 pandemic. In this lockdown setup, new forms of teaching and learning are taking shape beyond the formal setting of buildings and classrooms. So is it not possible with the tourism sector? We may require imagination, innovation, and creativity to bring back the tourism hospitality industry to the table once again. The night is the darkest before the dawn. An experienced player in any field would focus on the journey that awaits. So let us remember the words of Lyndon B. Johnson, the 36th President of the United States. He says, "Yesterday is not ours to recover, but tomorrow is ours to win or lose." I'm sure that this seminar will offer an effective platform for fruitful discussions and for sharing of knowledge, ideas, and experiences by the eminent resource persons, academicians, social scientists, and researchers present here today. Once again, a warm welcome to this international conference. I take this opportunity to thank the IQAC coordinators, Dr. Amrita Chaudhary and Mr. Alok John, for leaving no stone unturned to organize this conference. I also thank all the members of the IQAC, especially Professor Shala Yasmin, Dr. Aprajita Krishna, Dr. Sufia Fatima, Dr. Pallavi, and Sri Praveen for coordinating the program, and Dr. Bhavana and her team for their constant technical assistance. Thank you once again and a warm welcome. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sister. Thank you, sister, for your words of wisdom and encouragement. Your words mean a lot to us. With this, we have formally inaugurated this two-day international conference. Hope this two-day journey will be enriching to all the stakeholders. Welcome once again to all those who have joined now as we move on towards the first plenary session. The first plenary session is on service marketing and tourism. The session will be focusing on impacts on tourism sector during the current crisis and will discuss recovery strategies in particular. To deliver this plenary session, we have with us Professor Amar Iran Tigger, Director, Xavier Institute of Social Service, Ranchi. Professor Tigger is a renowned academician. He has nearly 18 years of experience in varied field. He's a person whose action speaks much louder. Professor Tigger is an alumni of ISM Dhanbad, where he completed his BTech and PhD degree. He has to his credit a PGDM degree from IIM Kolkata and an advanced course in marketing and management from IIM Lucknow. His research areas include brand and sales management. He has presented and published several research papers in national and international journals and conferences. He is also contributing to the corporate sector in various capacities. He strongly believes in giving back to society, and the list is much longer. So welcome, Professor Tigger, to this two-day international conference. Now let us have the privilege of listening to such an able professor of high repute. As the instructions have already been given, let me repeat those instructions. A small request to all the participants, please put up the questions related to the topic in question answer box and not in the chat box. As we are over with the session, we will have an interactive session with Sir and we'll take up those questions and discuss those questions. So now I hand over the session to Professor Amar Iran Tigger. Sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So very good morning to all of you.
Especially good morning, sir.
And Sister Rasmi, AC, Principal Patna Women's College. Sister Tanisa, Vice Principal, Patna Women's College. Dr. Aparajita for introducing me and conducting this international conference. Mr. Alok. It's really a matter of great pleasure for me connecting to Patna, because before coming to the academics, I was working in a Patna for Punjab National Bank for 4.5 years. So So I used to look after the whole Bihar state for the Punjab National Bank. Thank you, sister, for inviting me for this talk. I will try my best to share my knowledge, my understanding with all the participants, and we'll try to learn something out of this for the betterment of the society. I would like to welcome all the participants who have joined online to this international conference, not only to understand this academic world with the services, marketing and tourism, but understanding the practical nitty-gritty of this functions, where how we can understand the tourism and the betterment of the society and understanding the whole world. Starting with this, we first need to thank God that we are safe till date. This is the gratitude or the blessings God has given to us. We must thank God. And with this, we also try that who are suffering at present and who are suffering because of various reasons due to COVID-19, we must try to uplift them or support them, so that with our knowledge or whatever we can able to do, or with our understanding, with our strategies, the people who are losing jobs, the people who are suffering economically, the people who are losing their health, we can able to help them. The ultimate purpose of education and this academic sessions is to extend our hands to those people who are suffering. And this is what we have the objectives. So we all understand pandemic, as the WHO speaks, it's a worldwide spread of a new disease. And most of us, we don't have the immunity against that virus. And that's why it's a difficult to control, and we are suffering. And it has become fatal also. And with respect to when we talk about tourism, people traveling for fun, we keep on traveling every summers, like this summers also, every summers, many of the families go for different places, hill stations, sea places, abroad, to their villages, to the nature, to the forest, to spend a quality time to enjoy the nature. But this time, we are not able to do that. So we are not able to do the sightseeing and the camping and enjoying the various things of this earth. We all know, because of this COVID, because of this coronavirus, tourism sector is the worst affected among all the sectors. 60 to 80% of those people will not going to visit the different places for their fun, for their get together and like that. So if you see the book called Future Shock, written by Alvin Toffler, what is happening today is too many changes in a short time, and that's why it's a shock for us. Now the question comes that in this situation, because we all understand what is the present context and what is the present situation, who is ready to travel? When I inquire about our faculty members, the staffs, when we ask that you can you come to the offices, they are afraid. They have a lot of fear. They have a lot of apprehension. Sir, if you are traveling, what will happen to our health? May I get infected? So the question arises that who will travel in this situation? And if they want to travel, why? What is the purpose? Is it for fun? Or it's because of the business? Or it is because of the necessity? Or it is because of the treatment or health and like that? And if they want to travel, where they want to travel, what are their objectives? So with this understanding of this pandemic and the tourism sector, we all know the solution for this COVID-19, we have tried to understand, is seen as lockdown. To stay safe, we have been told to stay at home, and social distancing. This is what is the present solutions looked by every leader, because we don't have the medicines, we don't have the vaccinations at present. On the other hand, we also have realized that economical crisis is also going to kill many of us, especially when we are seeing the migrant labors, when we are seeing the factories are getting closed, many of the economical activities are not done. So that the questions arises, the thoughts arises that how to balance, because both are killing the people, both are making us suffer. So now we are in the consensus, we are of the understanding that balancing these two factors is the real game. Till we get the medicine, till we get the vaccinations developed, or any alternative methods to develop the immunity. But the reality is that no one really knows, or nobody is accurate on predicting what is going to happen tomorrow. Dear participants, we have to find the solutions in this uncertainty. So going ahead with this understanding, we need to understand tourism and the COVID-19. If we are plotting this understanding with the x-axis and the y-axis, COVID-19 cases, number of cases, and the tourism in the y-axis, if both are high, there is a high risk of getting infected. In this situation also, there are people, if it is allowed, if the lockdown is going to over, there are people who would like to travel. So if they travel, it means they are the risk takers. Or it may be that their immunity is high. Because if you see, the Infosys founder Narayan Murthy has told that we cannot continue our lockdown. We have to start working with the people who are having high immunity, or those people who are of less risk. And we try to protect the people who are vulnerable, like the old people, like the children's. And that way we can try to balance this. So if the people who are the risk takers, they will prefer the places where the crowd is not there. So it may happen that the people will prefer to go to the nature, they will prefer to go for the wildlife destinations, or they will prefer to the zone where we say the green zone, where the number of COVID cases are less. And this is what is the present time situation. And with the opening of the trains, railway, the airlines, taxis, things will change slightly. We will see that how the things are changing in that direction. If you see, the COVID cases are high and the tourism is low. This is what is very much expected, because as we have discussed that 60 to 80% people will not willing to travel in this situation. So most probably they will postpone till normal. And when this normal will come, we again don't know, or we are uncertain about this. It may happen that they will prefer the nearby destinations for spending quality time or just for the fun. They may prefer to go to the villages, or they may prefer to get to the places where the crowds are not there. They may try to explore the new places. And this is what is the present time to the next 6 months, maybe, where people will try to travel, because many of the people are really frustrated because of getting closed in a room. Some of my friends had just, they moved out to their villages because they have really not feeling well because of this close down and staying in only in their houses. And they went to their villages where the network is not there, and they are enjoying the rivers, the places, the villages, and their grandparents. So this is also maybe the traveling and the tourism can be there. Next is the when the COVID cases are low, also low, and the tourism is also low. This is also expected in the coming time, because we are at the verge of the economical crisis, the financial crisis. Because of this close down, the real impact will start now. Because as we daily see, the number of layoffs, the income is reduced because of the job getting away from the various people. People are not sure what to do and what not to do. So their incomes are getting reduced. It may happen, the people who have money, they will plan for the small budget visits or the tourism. And that way we need to plan that how it will match to their budgets. It may happen after the 6 months or so. Because of the financial meltdown, many of the people will not travel, and some of the people will travel and they will have a small budgets. And the last part of the quarter is that when we get into the normal situation, when the COVID-19 is also very low and the tourism is high. And that is the situation when we are back to normal. It may take 1 year, it may take 2 years. As per the news, many of the vaccinations are on the trial, even human trial has been started. But at the same time, based on the past experiences, the minimum time taken for the development of the vaccination is 4 years, what was last done. But because of the recent technologies, developed technology, it may happen that we can get an early vaccination and the medicine. Once we back to normal, destinations, all destinations will get open and people will start visiting. And it may happen that the demand will rise exponentially, because everybody will like to travel. And as the trust, now with this different situations, we need to understand the services marketing and the tourism. So if you see, many of the domestic travel destinations like Himachal, Ladakh, Goa, Uttarakhand, even Northeast, Andamans, Pondicherry, they are less infected. So it may happen that soon it will be the green zone, and then people may like to travel to those places if the airlines and all those things will start working. And it is already started. Road trips will be preferred. People will prefer their own car with their own family, not interacting with the external people. And definitely youngsters will try to drive out, especially on long weekends. Hometown stripping will be a big segment, and then local sightseeing. Luxury hotels will become cheaper to accommodate, as I told you, with the less budgets to attract more demand or better attraction or attracting the visitors. When we talk about this as the topic right now, we are dealing with the services marketing and the tourism. It's also, we need to understand services marketing in this new normal. Services marketing fundamentals will remain same, and it will remain same. The reliability of the services, the responsiveness of the organizations, the firms, the empathy of the employees, the assurance from the organizations, the various service providers, it must be there. And in fact, it is expected more in this situation. When we look about this marketing, 4Ps, 7Ps, product, price, place, promotion, the other 3Ps, people, physical evidence, and process, as we have discussed about the future shock, many things are getting changed in a very less time. So all the process, all the physical evidences, the working of the people, the standard operating procedure, we have to change, and we have to adapt. And we see that we all are adapting well. Today, it's the proof that we all are joining from our different locations for the virtual international call for a conference. And I see a lot of participation. It's really a success for this international conference also. I congratulate the team. So we people are adapting the situation and the context, and we are also fast adapting this. Even I see the people who are at the age of 55, 60, they are also getting well with the technology. So we are well talking in a room without seeing any people. So with the marketing, we need to build the trust. That is what is the most important when the customers and the people are doubting whether I should visit or not to visit, whether I should go for the tourism or not to do that, or whether I should travel or not to travel, or whether I should take this risk or not to take the risk. So communicating that you are safe, or building the trust in the customers that you are safe, we will take care of you in every situation, is what is the need if we want to recover the tourism sector. If we look into this services marketing triangle, we all know these are some of the theoretical things, but these are the universal truth. If you look up the company or the organizations, the tourism sector organizations, that travelers, the holiday organizers, the organizations, the hotels, airlines, many of the food servers, the organizations, the providers, and the customers. These are the three corners of this triangle. When we talk about external marketing in the services, we communicate through advertisements, we communicate through digital, and now YouTube is becoming one of the most preferred channel for communicating to the external world. In among the social media, all the channels, YouTube is the channel which is working well, because we can able to see, we can able to visualize with all the indicators or the things which we can able to visualize properly. So from there, how the different organizations, the hotels, the holiday organizations, all they are communicating with this, their videos, that we will see also some of the videos. So that way we are setting the promise. We are setting the promise. And when we talk about internal marketing, when the organizations, they ask their employees, the organizations are training their employees in this new normal, how to serve the food, how to sanitize the hotels, how to sanitize the cars, how to deal with the customers, how to empathize them, how to understand them, how to understand their needs. So we have to provide lot of gadgets. It may be thermal scanning, it may be for signing or the signatures, it may be the scanning of the QR code, it may be serving the food with the disposable plates and the spoons, housekeeping, everything. So you have to enable your employees and train the employees so that this infections, so that the customers will feel safe while doing the tourism. And that trust, when the word of mouth will spread, then the real marketing will happen. And that is what is called interactive marketing. When the customers comes in contact with the providers, they try to test and they see, they examine the what the organization has promised and what we have delivered. So the promising and the delivery of the services coming together, and that is what is the interactive marketing. So delivering the promise. So in this new normal, we have to deliver the new level of services. In this, all this triangle, now the technology, as we see, even in this, our international conference, technology is playing a bigger role. In fact, the role in connecting all of us. So in the tourism sector also, technology is going to be the real player to make everything safe and building the trust among the customers. So automation is the new thing which is happening. As soon as the customer enters the hotel, everything getting automated about their body temperature, about their scanning, about their sanitizations of their luggage, sanitization of their shoes, Many things are getting automated. The foods serves, the menu is also coming on their mobile, the digital menu and all that. All the payments are digital. So housekeeping and everything. So automation is becoming one of the important area in the various players in the tourism sectors. Digitalization is also one of the important area which is happening in this sector. And as we see that digitalization and this technology adoption was promoted before COVID, but the COVID is the new player or the factor which has made us that we have to go ahead with that. So the environment is contact free. So earlier when we used to talk about that human touch is required, but now with this new normal, we have to keep human touch away to really serve the people and to make the people happy. This is the new normal. So if you talk about this new normal, the services sector, which was supposed to be the labor intensive sector, and whose people are involved in this tourism sectors. And earlier we used to understand, and today also we used to think that tourism is a new engine for the growth of the economy for various places. But now this automations, artificial intelligence, robots are the new things which are coming into this sector. So COVID-19 has boosted the need of automations and machines manifold to make contact-free process. When we understand marketing, what is the job of marketing? The marketing job is to reduce the risk of the customer. Customers are ready to pay as per the prices, as per the cost. But what they want against that, they want the value for the money. They want to reduce their risk from whatever the solutions they purchase. It may be the product, it may be the services. So most of the risks we see when we talk about this is the performance risk, financial risk, social risk, safety risk. Everything we want to try to reduce. We give a guarantee to the customers. We give money back policies to the customers so that the customers have the comfort level of in their mind that whatever we are buying, we are rest assured that it will deliver. If not deliver, then it will be returned. Social risks are also there, that when we buy this, the people will feel proud of that. The people will not laugh at me. Earlier, when we are traveling from the flight, the safety was the real thing. That the flight, every airlines used to say that your safety is our priority. Now the new risk has come up, is the health risk. So it's not only airlines have to take care of their safety, but also they have to take care of the safety of their health also. So how we are addressing to this health risk is the new challenge for us. And this health risk, obviously, when we are talking about masks, when we are talking about sanitizations, when we are talking about providing the gloves as soon as the people are boarding, we are measuring the temperatures of the passengers. And these are the things which we are doing to reduce the health risk. Now, what will happen in this situation? The people who are trying to travel for the tourism, their zone of tolerance, when we talk about zone of tolerance, means the tolerance level between the expected services and the delivered services. Most of the time, what happens in the services sectors, when we deliver the services, it is either there is a gap in the gap from the customer expectations. Sometimes people used to adjust the zone of tolerance, may be more wider. But now the zone of tolerance will be less because it is going to directly impact their health. And health is one of the very important factors for any individual. So that is also one of the risks to reduce by the marketers, by the organizations, to get the repeat business, to get the repeat visitors, to get a positive word of mouth among the tourists. So if you talk about the various providers in the tourism sectors, like when we talk about airlines. From yesterday itself, Airports Authority of India has started the flights. Many of the flights had got cancelled, but many of the flights have started. So when Ministry of Civil Aviation have already started these guidelines to build the trust among the customers, if they are saying that not to plan your journey if the body temperature is high or if symptomatic of the COVID-19, they are asking that register on Arogya Setu app. You must wear face mask, hand gloves. Passengers have to maintain social distancing at all the times. Passengers shall do a web check-in and carry a printout of board card from their home. So all different informations and the instructions are passed on to this new normal. And we are seeing that there is a high level of booking of the tickets. And people are even traveling till 6th May, even the middle seats are allowed to book for the seats. I'm just sharing a small video to all of you to understand how the
बेसिक चीज़ें हम वो देख रहे हैं जो कि पैसेंजर के जितने भी टच पॉइंट्स हैं जहाँ जहाँ पे पैसेंजर का हाथ लगता है या शूज़ है या जो भी जो पैसेंजर टच पॉइंट्स हैं उनको हम मिनिमाइज़ करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं बेसिकली। जैसे ही पैसेंजर अंदर आता है हम उसका जो शूज़ को हम डिसइंफेक्ट कर लेते हैं, उसके बाद में उसका थर्मल स्क्रीनिंग करके और उसका थर्मल स्कैनिंग दोबारा से होता है एक बार हमारे पास में, और आईडी वगैरह चेक करके उसको डिस्टेंसिंग से जो आपने देखा अभी जो प्रोसीजर आपने सारे, उसके बाद में हम लोग उनको अंदर लेकर के आते हैं जहाँ पर जितने भी चेक पॉइंट्स हैं आईडी पॉइंट्स हैं उनको हमने स्क्रीन के पीछे से करने की कोशिश की है सब जगह, ताकि जो भी ड्रॉपलेट्स है मुँह से वो दूसरे बंदे तक ट्रांसमिट ना हो सके। इसके बाद जो बोर्डिंग कार्ड हैं हम लोग ये प्रोसीजर हमने बनाया है कि बोर्डिंग कार्ड वो अपने हाथों से खुद निकालें पैसेंजर जो आपने आज देखा, तो ताकि उनका जो उसका स्टाफ के साथ में कोई कांटेक्ट ना रहे।
सो दिस वाज अबाउट द एयरलाइंस। वंस देन नेक्स्ट वी कैन सी अ टैक्सी फ्रॉम द कोची। how they have separated the passengers part and the driver part with a fiber glass. So this type of taxi is already started moving for the tourists and for all the passengers. So what we say that crisis leads to transformation. The world is not going to stop. And this COVID is also not going to last forever. So people are looking for the solutions. So this is about the taxi. When we talk about the hotels and restaurants, hotels are getting huge changes in operational process, entrance, sanitization, cubicle, shoes and luggage sanitizations, auto thermal scanning. So many gadgets are coming up and the housekeeping staffs are also with the PPE. It's not only in the hospitals, but also in the airlines, in the hotels, in the taxis, in the various places, the people are wearing the PPE, personal protective equipments, and all the things, disposable food packets, employee attendance are done by the facial recognitions, and so many new products are coming up. Salt and sugars cannot be done and put in a bottles, but in a sachet. Distancing by tables, some of the video I will just show you in this regard also. So just see one international hotel called Kempinski. They have just made a tie-up with Lila Groups of Hotels, and they have opened one hotel in Delhi. And most of the hotels, this hotel is in abroad. So if you see their video, how they are telling that you can visit to their places.
Welcome to Kempinski. I hope you get a pleasant journey. My name is Alina. I'm a brand ambassador lady in red. So allow me to accompany you throughout the whole journey. Before the entering hotel, please kindly scan the healthy QR code, and while it goes green, you can continue with the temperature. Please stand closely so machine can check your temperature. After temperature test is complete, you may continue with registration. These days, it is very important to keep the safe distance, so we put the necessary marks on the floor. Thank you. All the hotel employees are wearing masks for the safety reasons. Please rest assured that your room key was disinfected. We offer our guests the hand sanitizer and a face mask for free. Our utmost priority is to provide a healthy and safe environment for all the guests and employees in our hotels worldwide. So please allow me to show you our rooms. The hotel public areas have been disinfected. Elevator buttons and services have been disinfected as well, frequently. Welcome to Kempinski Rooms. Here we provide you air purifier machine, which is on for 24 hours to make the air clean and pure. Please rest assured that our guest room amenities and linens are disinfected after every checkout. Also, we are frequently open the windows to let the fresh air in. Kempinski Bakery is a worldwide famous. Even in those difficult times, we do not compromise our food quality. Please follow me. Here we still maintain the safe distance between the guests, and all the employees are wearing the masks. As you can see, we have a great selection of the cakes. This one is actually my favorite. Can I have one, please? Also, you can order all of them online. So here, you can pick up your order. Thank you. Kempinski is always happy to please you with a different food experience. Welcome to one of our restaurants.
Hi. Table for one?
Yes, for me only.
Just scan the health kit.
Okay.
From the temperature check. Temperature is 36.2.
We're doing everything possible to provide a healthy and safe environment for you. Our waitress cleaning the table every few hours. Besides, the tables are also placed in between a safe distance. Our daily components for the food are fresh and clean. Besides, you can order everything online, including our beautiful beer. We always prepare all the necessary items for your own safety, including the hand sanitizer, face mask, and the gloves. Hello. Kempinski offers you a great selection of outstanding venues. Allow me to introduce one of them. All the room facilities are sanitized per usage. The seats are placed in a safe distance, at least 1 meter. All the employees are working here, wearing a face mask, and always here to serve you. It's always nice to enjoy a drink after a long day, but before, please complete the health safety procedure. Hi.
Hello,
long time no see. May I have my special drink?
Of course,
just a second,
please.
By scanning this QR code, our guests can receive their complimentary drink to start their evening.
Is that a Centrum Gin and Tonic?
Great.
Good.
I will. Thank you. Attila is our director of beverage who has a lot of international awards, so he will make you even unforgettable with his special drinks. We hope you enjoyed staying with us, and we're looking forward to welcome you to Kempinski very soon.
About the international hotel, when we come back to the India, so there is a one hotel called Sarovar Lilac Hotel. I'll just show you that it's not that the metro cities or the international, they are maintaining the hygiene and the methods or the standing operating procedures or different equipments, but even in Ranchi, Patna, people at the hotels are working hard to make the visitors, the tourists, protective from COVID or the coronavirus, and building the trust among the tourists that they can visit even in this new normal situation. Just see one video of the Indian hotels.
Namaste. This video will take you through contactless guest arrival and departure experience at Sarovar Hotels, where every touch point is converted into safety points without compromising guest experience. Security at the gate to meet and greet the guest with greetings, Namaste. Thermal screening and sanitizers to be offered at hotel porch. If temperature shows more than 98.5 Fahrenheit, guest is politely guided for medical help. For resident guest, prior reservation is essential. Free arrival communication for contactless check-in to be shared with guest by reservations team, and ID proof to be requested on email. Guest luggage to be spray sanitized and rubbed by bell desk. Baggage scanner to be well sanitized. Front desk to welcome guest with standard greetings, Namaste, and offer mask and sanitizer to guest. Front desk associate to request guest to sign on registration card and healthcare checklist document as per LIU norms. Front desk associate to hand over sanitized key card wearing gloves. Check-in and check-out counters to be separated and floor markings to be done to aid social distancing. Minimum interaction with guest and no escorting or room orientation to follow social distancing protocol. For non-resident guest, purpose of visit to be ascertained and directed accordingly. All non-resident guest activity to be restricted at lobby level. Restaurant visit to be encouraged by prior booking to plan seating with social distancing norm. Accessed by non-resident guests to be sanitized as per schedule. For guest transportation, driver to wear face mask and gloves. car to be sanitized thoroughly and frequent touch points to be sanitized frequently. Driver to ensure minimum interaction with guests and offer mask and sanitizer, ensuring social distancing. High touch areas like door handles, elevator buttons, handrails, telephones, and remote controls are to be sanitized as and when required. On guest departure, contactless bill payment procedure to be followed. Request for guest feedback on online comment card. And inform guest that e-invoice will be shared on registered email ID. Thank you for watching. Namaste. This video will take.
Just I will show you the small video for the food serving, because food is one of the important area.
Namaste. Take you through operating standards for contactless in-room. These standards need to be maintained by associates with an endeavor to incite guest faith. In-room dining service design to incorporate all possible safety measures. Here are the service guidelines for contactless in-room dining. Guest service associate to always wear personal protective equipments like hair cover, face mask, and protective gloves before entering in-room. Biodegradable bento boxes, disposable bamboo cutlery, and biodegradable glassware to be used. Only in-room dining trolley to be used for service, as length of trolley enables 1 meter gap between guest and associates. For small orders like tea, coffee, beverages, and snacks, tray may be used on trolley and guest can pick up trolley on delivery. It needs to be ensured that in-room dining trolleys are cleaned and sanitized after every use by spraying approved disinfectant. When arriving at a guest room, guest service associate announces himself and places the trolley as barrier between himself and the door to ensure social distancing. The following script to be used when the guest arrives at the door. Namaste, Mr. Singh. My name is Pradeep. Your order for Indian veg combo meal. Mr. Singh, keeping in mind our initiatives on social distancing, may I request you to please sign on the bill and pull the trolley inside. It was a pleasure serving you, Mr. Singh. Please do reach us on in-room dining for clearance and do leave the trolley outside the door. Please do let us know if further assistance required. Enjoy your meal. The acknowledgement is taken on a sanitized check stationery. The same is placed in UV box before it is settled. After every visit to the guest room, the guest service associate to sanitize himself through hand wash and change of gloves. Guest service associate needs to ensure biomedical waste such as gloves and mask to be disposed separately. Hotel safety and hygiene sticker note to go with every room service order. Room service experience maker. It is recommended all guest and service touch points to be sanitized. Namaste. This video will take you through Sarovar. Safety standards need to be maintained by attendants with an endeavor to incite guest faith. Here are service guidelines for housekeeping services at our hotel.
Just a request, sir.
Every touch points are converted into.
Just a request, sir.
Time
we are running short of time.
Okay, yes, sir. So just we tried to this we the last slide because
okay sir
so just I have tried to show you because talking about this new normal is really difficult to believe. So what is the future with the positivity? we have to be responsible tourism. We have to do responsible tourism so that each and everyone are safe. This pandemic has really hit hard to the travel and tourism sectors, no doubt about that. It nevertheless offers a rare opportunity for us to reflect and recalibrate our sectors of tourism and to grow better for the planet and people, both, because this lockdown has given many things positive also. The recovering of the planet is itself is one of the good areas. COVID-19 pandemic is not permanent. This very obvious. So just for 1 or 2 years, we have to manage and we have to survive. And obviously, when we talk about this Alibaba CEO, he talks about that for this year, survival is the profit. So many of the small players in the tourism sectors and the people have to just survive and work minimum. And the things are coming up, like FSSAI will tell about the food quality of the places you will visit. The TripAdvisor, Make My Trip, and so many the travel websites will tell you which are the preferred destinations and the safe destinations. So with this, we try to see that there are various videos and other things are available. You can have a confidence, but the only thing is that once the people will put a step outside, then they will able to realize the things. And it will take a little bit of time once they will start getting the word of mouth from the people that, okay, they have traveled and the things will come. So adopt the various survival practices and try to, you can utilize this time for the training of your employees, rethink on the feedbacks of the past customers, do events for the locals with the low cost, happy for the improved planet situations. And the thing is that we have to move on. The life has to move on. With this, I would like to thank you, all the organizations and the participants for passionately listening to me. And with this, I would like to thank you. And if any questions are there, I'm happy to answer that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you
for this enriching lecture and giving us an insight to the strategies of tourism sector. As you have explained it in detail, graphically and with video. And the fear of visiting places are coming down slowly. Days will take that fear from us so that the contactless tourism sector will take a new bound. Few issues are still there, but with this, as you said, sir, the COVID-19 has bring people together at a distance. We are at a distance, but emotionally we are bound together. So as you have mentioned in your lecture, village tourism will increase. This will increase the emotional bonding of the people. And sure, this village tourism will take new fold in it. Nature tourism and wildlife sanctuaries tourism, this will bring another environmental friendly activities to be taken. The bonding in relationship may increase, sir. And since this vaccine is in progress and the technology is taking in, this technology will bring us more contactless tourism to take place. Thank you once again, sir, for this enriching experience that we had with the video lectures and the lecture that you have given us. There are a few questions, but winding up because we are running short of time also, and our next speaker is present. So just a one suggestion type of a question, which I'm taking with the similar questions that has already been given, especially in state where we belong to, Bihar, Jharkhand, and UP, there are the migrant laborers have come back from this tourism sector also. We really need to train those people in the villages so that when this sector is fully active, then they are well prepared to get into the industry. From you, sir?
Yeah, so the last part, ma'am.
This tour, the migrant laborers that have come up, there are questions related to this only. The migrant laborers that have come to our state, Bihar, UP, Jharkhand, all these states, and they are from the tourism industry. If this type of contactless trainings are given to them in their villages, so they are well prepared within 6 months or a year, when they go back to their industry, they are well prepared to get into the tourism industry and get employability.
Yeah, very true, ma'am. With this migrant labors, definitely they have come back to the states, and it's a matter of proud also that we are getting back them. So this is an opportunity for each of our state that we can utilize them. Training can be done online through phones and that way through videos. That is now what the technology helps us in getting that. So in fact, in the Ranchi, NHRD is trying to build the inventory of the skills people are coming with, and trying to connect with the local hotels or the local villages, and that way we are trying to promote the local tourism, and that way we can able to retain them forever also. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. And academicians of your repute may give more trainings to them, which can bring them skill enhancement in their work sector also.
Thank you.
Once again, sir. And this, we are short of time. We start the second plenary session just after this. And thanks for conducting this first plenary session in such a brilliant manner. To conduct the second plenary session, may I now invite Dr. Sufia Fatima, Head Department of Commerce, Patna Women's College, to start the session. Without break, we start the second plenary session. It's over to you, Sufia.
No, ma'am, you're not audible, ma'am.
Sufia, you need to put your mic on. Yes.
Ma'am, Sufia, ma'am, kindly
Sufia,
unmute
ma'am,
yourself.
You are still on mute. Please put your speaker on.
A very sunny, bright good noon to everyone. I, Dr. Sufia Fatima, Head Department of Commerce, take the privilege to moderate this session. I take the opportunity to heartily welcome one and all to the second plenary session of 2 days International Web Conference on COVID-19 Pandemic and World Tourism Hospitality Trends, Challenges and Future Prospects, organized by Internal Quality Assurance Cell, Patna Women's College, Autonomous Patna University. I welcome everyone on board. Here we begin this second plenary session wherein we have a special lecture by our eminent resource person on impact of COVID-19 on tourism. So we are extremely delighted to have Professor Dr. Moshumi Datta virtually joining us today on this platform. I feel elated to heartily welcome Professor Dr. Moshumi Datta, Professor in Geography and Vice Principal, Nagin Das Khanwala College, Autonomous, Mumbai. Professor Datta has a teaching experience of over 26 years with technical skills in education technology, remote sensing, GIS, and GPS. Madam is a keen researcher, and over 85 research papers of her have been published in the journals of national and international repute. She has significantly contributed in the REAMS through various successful minor and major research projects. Professor Datta has presented several research papers in foreign universities as well. To name a few, Pennsylvania University, Princeton University, and many more in the United States of America. And she has also presented innumerable papers also in many universities of the United Kingdom. She has been awarded by the Indus Foundation of United States of America Award for a commendable contribution in research. With enough ecstasy, I welcome you, ma'am, from the deepest core of my heart for this plenary session. I also take the opportunity to welcome all the participants on board. We appreciate the presence of all of you. Dear participants, you are requested not to spam the chat box with queries, and also that no attendance is marked on the basis of chat box messages. We appreciate if the participants put their queries in Q&A box. Your queries will be addressed at the end of this session. So moving on, we are now going to witness this upcoming 20 minutes, which are going to be a learning and enriching experience for all of us. So I now invite Professor Dr. Moshumi Datta to kindly take over the session. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Dr. Sufia. Good afternoon to all. At the outset, I would like to thank the college management, principal, the IQSC team for inviting me for this lecture. I'm really honored to be here today. Can I share my screen now, madam?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
It was really a very enriching lecture by Professor Tigger, and I found that some of the points may be coinciding with him, but I would definitely like to give a different flavor to these points. Now, my topic is COVID-19, we all know, and its impact on tourism industry. Now, to start with, this coronavirus pandemic has actually brought the world to a standstill. It is very hard to ignore at present the effects of this novel coronavirus pandemic is having on our everyday life. Now, right from social distancing to quarantines to the closure of schools and institutions, the world has changed. This is not the same world where we have been living for so many years. Actually speaking, when I was preparing for my topic and with several newspapers on, several economic reviews on, we can say that tourism is perhaps the worst affected economic sectors due to this COVID-19. Actually, coronavirus has practically crippled the world travel. Now we all know for so many days now we have been quarantined in our homes. We have been cooking and cleaning for ourselves, and we are also avoiding eating out. And this has actually affected the hospitality industry. It is going through a severe losses. When it comes to travel, both our international and domestic flights were banned. It is only yesterday a domestic flight has started. That also for essential travels, it has started. So all this has crippled our air industry as well. Actually speaking, this tourism industry, when we think this the closing down of the iconic Taj Mahal from March, this was an evocative symbol that how India's travel and tourism landscape has changed due to COVID-19. Actually, travel and tourism industry depends on free and a confident movement of the people. And that is disappearing from this world. So with the tourism industry to such a state, with the disappearing jobs, we can really see a grave future for this sector. Let us find out that what are the severe impacts and how well we can recover this sector in a proper manner. If we go back, there's a devastating impact of COVID-19 on this tourism industry. According to UNWTO 2019, it says that 1 in 10 jobs are in tourism. Tourism accounts for 7% of the global exports. Travel and tourism industry contributes 10% to India's GDP. And this COVID-19, according to CII, has made a loss of rupees 5 lakh crores only in tourism sector. And this perhaps will give rise to enormous joblessness, almost 5 crore loss of jobs. And that is really very striking and very, very dangerous. We need to look upon this very well. If we go back and we study the GDP contributions, the GDP, we find that right from 1961 to 2019, there were years where the GDP was very, very slow. And there were some years like 1964, 1968, 1969, 1973, and even we find that the GDP was quite high. Again, you know, 2008 recession, the GDP was almost negative. But if we see the total GDP and the contribution by travel and tourism industry, we find that travel and tourism industry has outpaced the total GDP growth. That itself tells us that how important our tourism industry is for our economic sector. On our economic sector, there are many countries in the world which totally dependent on the tourism. And with such impact everywhere, we can say that we are going actually to a economic recession. There are some countries like Thailand, Poland, Portugal, Jamaica, Spain, Turkey, Dominican Republic, were totally dependent on tourism. So for these countries, coming back in a short term will really be very, very difficult. Actually speaking, it is always said that although recession is on, but now we have to revive this tourism industry very, very differently. It is just like a red matchstick among all the blue ones. So we need to be different. Once we are different, we have proper strategies at place, definitely tourism industry will be back. Maybe not very shortly, but in the long run, definitely. If we see the, or if we study Onku's laws, what does Onku's law say? Onku's laws is very, very applicable to tourism industry now. Onku's law says that, that with every 1% increase in unemployment, there is a decrease of 2% in GDP. So this itself proves that we cannot let go the tourism industry just like that. The government has to step in. The government has to take proper care of this industry so that our total GDP rises up. Government intervention and steps are very much required for this particular industry. Now that will not happen in a day. Even uplifting of a lockdown will not bring sunshine to these industries, because the travelers, the people who are locked in the houses for so long, we cannot expect them that they will be gushing out and they will be traveling. So unless and until the fear of this coronavirus goes away. So it will take time, but this government intervention and steps are very much required for this industry to come up. What we require now, we require in the short run, we require a very responsible, sustainable and socially innovative tourism. Gone are the days of for a hurried traveler. Now we need to have slow tourism. We need to have staycations. Now, slow tourism goes generally at a very, very slow pace, where there is a personal interaction with the locals, where there is authentic travel experience, where there is a greater consumption of local products, where there is use of clean energy. So this will actually develop. Whenever slow tourism develops, new types of businesses develops. What are these new types of businesses? Maybe 0 kilometer markets develop, artisan markets develop, etc. Now this huge number of laborers who are unemployed now due to the negative stage of tourism industry, we have to employ them in local tourism. Local tourism will be the main factor as of now, looking at the current scenario. If we see what are the great experts in different countries are feeling about revival of this industry, you know, France has already started developing local tourism. Recently, they have started with a program called hashtag Explore Paris, because they know it is a local tourism in the first place which will help them to revive, and then they can see the other types of tourism in the future. Even the high-end hotels in Paris are now offering to the local population very large discounts for overnight stays. So all these small initiatives will develop the local tourism initially, because people will avoid long time travels. And for local tourism to develop, again, we require the government to invest. So now it is a time of sustainability. It is a time of staycation. It is a time of green tourism. It is a time of sustainable tourism. What about virtual tourism? Even virtual tourism is picking up now with the current state of mind. Now in virtual tourism, in virtual tours, generally we have the simulation of an existing location where with the help of a video or with the help of still images. And there are other factors like there is a music, there is a sound effect, there is a floor pan, etc. So recently, the Ministry of Tourism in India has started Dekho Apna Desh. And Dekho Apna Desh, what is happening? They are doing it virtually. And maybe in future, the areas which are not very much affected will pick up. will pick up. So that is the only way by which virtual tourism and tourism can be developed in the long run. When I was just looking through how COVID has actually impacted the tourism sector, I was just taking some case studies, and I just wanted to share with you the tourism, that some places which are totally dependent on tourism industry, how they are reacting. Take, for example, Kullu Manali. Kullu Manali is also closed from March 22nd, 2020. And we all know Kullu Manali is a place where all Indians crop through during the month of summer. But at present, there are 2 lakh jobless people. Now, there are tremendous adventurous sports like river rafting, paragliding, mountain hiking. So all these people are totally unemployed. The restaurants, the dhabas, the taxi drivers, the photographers, and also the village woman who actually used to dress up the tourists in the local attire, even they are jobless. So tourism industry is in utter despair now. So what do we need to do? We need to have a bailout package. Who will give us this bailout package? It is definitely by the government. The government has to think of some bailout packages, especially for these small areas where tourism is the main economic activity. Let's move south. If we move south, we can take the example of Thiruvananthapuram. Now, Thiruvananthapuram is the same place that we find that over here also, it is during the summer season that tourism is at its peak. But now if you see the hotels, the resorts, the lodges, the tour operators, every one of them see a very uncertain future. And Thiruvananthapuram has been very unlucky, you know, because in 2018, there were floods, there was Nipah virus scare. So already they were trying to come up, and suddenly you have this COVID-19 breakdown in 2020. So what will happen to the people who are actually surviving? Their only source of food and shelter was tourism. The government needs to think definitely. I'm sorry for this mess of my, yeah. So if we look at the expected recovery, one fine morning we get up and we see our tourism industry is totally recovered. No, that is not possible. Expected recovery will always have in phases. In the first phase, like yesterday when the air travel started, it is mostly the essential travelers, the people traveling back home. We have read in today's newspaper how a small child of 5 years old have returned back to his mother. So it is the essential travelers which will actually develop. In the subsequent phases, maybe sometime business travel and leisure travel will take a long time. Domestic travel definitely can show some green shoots. International travel is a long challenge now. So it is very, very challenging for travel and tourism industry. They have to prepare for the worst. Especially, I'm talking of the middle and the small enterprises who dominate the sector. It's very unlikely they can revive on their own. They need a financial backup, and then only they can revive. So how will be the expected travel behavior post-lockdown? As my respected earlier speaker has already said that we need to prioritize our safety and hygiene. People now will be shifting to destinations which are less known. And moreover, there should be innovative in-room experiences, because people now are quite scared to mix up. So there should be proper in-room experiences. Maybe boutique hotels will pick up, homestays will pick up, but MICE travel is a long, long way, because already we are having a concept of work from home, and Zoom meetings has already taken over, I believe, to some type of MICE. So our travel behavior will also change. However, the turnaround strategy can only be given by the government. We have to remember, the government has to realize that this industry has to start from the scratch. So first of all, the government has to provide some short and mid-term liquidity, at least to meet the fixed costs. Fixed cost is the like the rent, for example, the labor force salary. So for meeting the fixed cost, it is the government who can take. In the long run, even the government can think of GST tax-free holidays. All these small things, small strategies can actually develop the tourism sector. So what is the recovery plan? How will the recovery plan of our tourism industry will look like? Will it be V, U, W, L, or a final D? Let us find out. As I said, people just after lockout, people will just not come out of their house and start traveling. So V-shaped, I don't find it is visible. Not even U-shaped, because U-shaped says that after some time it picks up. W was, till yesterday night, I was quite favorable for W. But today, WHO has already said that coronavirus can make a second resurgence. If coronavirus makes a second resurgence, maybe tourism industry has gone down, come up, and again, it will make a downfall. L-shaped recovery can also be expected in some places when it takes a long time to recover. However, many experts pointed out D word, that is a depression. Generally, depression word, we don't like to point out every time. But they say of muted recovery, it will take time. Why not we give 5 years for this tourism sector to develop? But this 5 years, who will look after the unemployed staff? It is the government. They have to come up with the economic package. They're just like the economic package, unless and until that is done, it is very difficult for the industry to survive. My earlier speaker has also pointed out about future shock. So am I doing, because this is the time when we are studying about, when we want to share something about tourism industry, we speak of this futurist Alvin Toffler, that he has already said about too much changes in too short a period of time. Maybe whatever he has said, he has written this book right in 1977-78. Whatever he has written, maybe some points are irrelevant, but this type of change in too short a period of time, we are definitely noticing in tourism industry after during this COVID-19. We see the country boundaries has been sealed. We find the cities has become standstill. The aeroplanes are grounded. The cruise ships, they are harbored in the ports. The railways, only necessary travel railways for migrant workers is working now. The buses are not plying. The hotels are shut. The restaurants are shuttered. What we are waiting for? Simple. We are waiting for a vaccine. Unless and until the vaccine comes out, this tourism sector will not have a proper ground to develop. So what can be the recovery? What can be the recovery measures for this industry? When we're talking of recovery, what can be the recovery measures? I simply have to remember CPVDN. What is the CPVDN? C is score. We have to remember of social distancing and sanitization. P is the protocols. Protocol of checking temperature for staff and guests. V, vaccine. Once the vaccine develops, leisure travel will definitely develop. D is domestic travel. Definitely, if we rework on the strategies, this sector will gain some profit. And N is the new norms. Maybe just after the terror attack, you know, there's a checking of Aadhaar card has become compulsory in the hotels. Maybe in this new norm, your medical certificate of the guest will become compulsory. Whatever it is, let us think something positive. The positive is that tourism sector is definitely a resilient sector, because tourism sector, if we look back and study, we find that it has gone to several storms. It has faced 9/11 attack. It has faced the SARS. It has faced the Mumbai attack of 26/11. So it will go through. Maybe the phase is long, but this definitely tourism industry will come back strong. So in this recovery measure, when the government announced the Atmanirbhar scheme with the economic packages, very sadly, tourism industry did not find any place. I have not gone through that. What is the amount which will be invested for tourism sector for its revival? Now, FAITH, Federation of Association in Indian Tourism and Hospitality, they have requested to Niti Aayog that for COVID-19, a fund of rupees 50,000 crores is required. I was talking of the fixed cost, which is required. And all this 50,000 crores should be given as an interest-free loan for a 10-year period. Because unless and until this type of support, a backbone, strong backbone is created, this industry will face lots of difficulty to come up. As Madam Aprajita was also saying about the fear, definitely we are scared. We are scared to travel now. We are scared of the unknown, scared of the infection. Even we are scared of touching someone or being touched. And we are scared of being infected. So now our mask, our gloves, our social distancing, vaccine, all this should be at place for the tourism sector to revive. So my talk has definitely said that our tourism industry is totally crippled now because the country borders, as I said, has not opened. And some geographies are totally no-no for us. And China is a negative territory, definitely. Business travel, mostly with Zoom meetings. MICE has already gone into coma, perhaps. Mega events like the Olympics of Tokyo that has been canceled. The Expo, which was supposed to be there in Dubai, that has been canceled. Group travel will shrink because people will now like to travel alone. Leisure travel, it is dwindling. I find it will take quite a long time. Even students study abroad, that will become lessened. Religious tourism, definitely low. Mature travel was quite an important part of travel, but that will also become less. But I can see a green shoot in domestic travel. If with proper support, everything is taken care of, maybe domestic travel can take up, and then in the long run, we can take some other measures for other type of tourism to be done. Destination weddings, which is a fashion of the day, definitely will take a setback. Educational trips will dry away. Again, isolated locations will win. That has been already discussed previously. Air travel, we never know. Now it is not expensive, but we never know about the future, that whether it will become expensive or not. Luxury hotels definitely is cheaper. Yes, with luxury hotels, your local tourism can be developed, and that can be an incentive for tourism sector. Cruise tourism will totally be shunned. Road trips will definitely gain, and hometown trippings will rise. We have to remember five very important words for this tourism sector now: safety, health, hygiene, brand, and value. We have to understand the new normal. We have to be with the change. That is why I call it copability. It is not capability now. Just copability, how well we can cope up, how well we can have this government initiative, how well we can use this government initiative in every loop and corner of this industry, it will help us to develop. So do we travel again? Definitely we will. How long we will stay back at home? We have to have a start, but I can say at present, our tourism industry is in life support. And whenever we are in a life support, what we require? We require a ventilator. We require a survival package. So our ventilator should be the government. The government should have some survival packages. And the government should come out with some active fiscal policies. And then only this tourism sector can develop. Crisis is there. But we say that whenever there are many crises, there are opportunities also. Whenever our crises are bigger, the opportunity, number of opportunities also become much more larger. So what is my final thoughts? My final thoughts is that we require help. support, service, guidance, assistance, advice. Recovery can be done, but we will have to, tourism industry has to reach up to the top. When we are reaching up to the top, yes, there might be small, some industries, small offices, which might struggle. Some will succeed, some will even perish, but the recovery will be slow, but we will definitely be at the peak with this tourism industry. I end my talk with a big hope for this tourism industry. And I hope with next time when I come and speak to you, tourism industry will be at its peak. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your such an elaborate, illustrative and visionary thoughts and contents. I heartily thank you. And ma'am, you have really brought it to light that there is a devastating impact of COVID-19 on employment, and many countries in the world which are mainly dependent on tourism, like Thailand, Poland, Turkey and Jamaica, are going to really face major setback both in the short run as well as the long run. Ma'am, you very well explained the concept of slow tourism, and employing the laborers in the local tourism can be seen as one of the solutions. And now is the time for staycation, green tourism, and virtual tourism. Thank you so much, ma'am. And we're really amazed to find the various dimensions of recovery plans and recovery measures. Ma'am, with your permission, can we take a few questions from our participants?
Yes, as definitely.
Okay. So the first question is of Ms. Neha Singh. She wants to know whether economic packages may be served to the vulnerable sections of this industry or not as a solution.
Yes. Actually, what has happened, as I told you, I was quite surprised that in the scheme of economic packages in Atmanirbhar scheme, tourism was not mentioned. But I had spoke about this in my talk also, that economic packages are required especially for the fixed costs. You know, you just because an industry is not surviving in this COVID, you cannot say a bid goodbye to the laborers. You cannot do that. That is not the way of reviving our economy. The laborers are there to stay. So with this, if we get some package, then we can at least maintain these laborers. Maybe a subsidy, some amount of percentage can be cut from the salary, but at least their job will stay, their house will run. So,
okay, thank you.
Sector, yeah, I'm looking this from this point of view.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. The second
local
question
tourism again, and local tourism again. If we start with local tourism, it is the people who are required. Tourism is such an area where we need people. We need people. We need two hands of the laborers. Otherwise, tourism industry cannot survive.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, the second question which is coming to our way is, what are the remedies announced by the government of India so far for the revival of tourism industry?
It has not been announced. It is not
nothing.
Yes, it is not there. If you read the Atmanirbhar package very well, it is not there for tourism. I'm hoping it will be there. And it has
yes.
there. Otherwise, it will become very difficult for this industry to survive. And it is a labor-intensive industry. It is giving such a lot for its GDP. We need to have tourism industry at place.
Yes, ma'am. And moving on, due to the paucity of time, we're able to take just one more question. And the question says that how to create job for migrant laborers who cannot be fit into the local tourism industry, as a suggestion given by you.
You see, I was speaking of a zero market, 0 kilometer market. I was speaking of artisans. So there must be some skills. You know, everyone cannot come and everyone cannot be there. And when we are dealing with migrant laborers, they cannot be done with the, I cannot say that you be online, I be online, I will teach you online and train you online. No, that cannot happen. We have to wait for some time and it has to be face to face, because they are definitely illiterate group and that is why they are migrant laborers in some other state. So maybe whatever skill they have, like in a market, when we develop slow tourism, there is more interaction with the locals. So now it is a time where our local sector should be developed. So somewhere or the other, the government will find its place for the migrant laborers.
Very true, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks.
Thank you.
So on behalf of Patna Women's College, I would like to extend gratitude and thankfulness from the deepest core of my heart to Professor Dr. Moshabi Datta for her extremely valuable insights and knowledge augmenting session. Thank you, ma'am, for all your words of wisdom and suggestions. I would also like to thank all the participants for their active participation and engrossed involvement. All the very best to all of you. Inquisitions and queries regarding certificates and feedback will be entertained and answered in the valedictory session. Now this is the time to disperse for the lunch break. Our next session, that is the first technical session, will start. There are in the timings, and this first technical session in which papers will be presented, so we request all the paper presenters to be ready with their papers and to check all the technical requirements. Thank you so much for the presence, and I would also like to say that the next technical session will be moderated by Dr. Amrita Chaudhary, Department of Geography, Women's College. She's also the coordinator of internal quality assurance at Patna Women's College and a keen researcher. Thank you so much, everyone. So enjoy your lunch, which is going to be thrilled and filled with loads of enrichment and enlightenment. Thank you once again. Over to you, ma'am, Amrita ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sophia. There's a information for all the participants. As we are running a little late as per our stipulated time, so now we'll break, we'll disperse for a lunch break that is for 15 minutes duration. So just now it is 12:50, so we will be back 5 past 1 after a 15 minutes lunch break. All the participants are requested to back for the technical session. Now, you are requested not to leave the meeting. You can just mute your audio and video, and after 15 minutes, enjoy your short lunch, and we'll begin the technical session at 1:05. All the paper presenters are requested to join by 1 p.m. so that we can see the connectivity issues and other technical aspects. So thank you for a short break. Thank you.
Okay.
Good afternoon, all of you. We have rejoined in this post-lunch session. That is the first technical session of the online international conference on COVID-19 pandemic and world tourism hospitality, trends, challenges, and future prospects, organized by the IQAC of Patna Women's College Autonomous. So we are extremely happy to have so many participants with you. We are very happy for your lively enthusiasm, wholehearted enthusiasm you have shown for participating and for presenting your papers. Due to paucity of time and due to some other technicalities, we have selected these papers, these presenters, and we have kept you, all of you, in these two technical sessions. The first technical session we are beginning just now. The most of the papers which will be presented in this technical session, these are related to the impact part of COVID pandemic. The impact on economy, impact on social sector, the other aspects emerging out of the COVID-19 impact on tourism and hospitality sector. So some some important things to remember, all the participants, for you, 5 minutes of time is given for each participant. So you just are requested to limit your presentation within that time framework so that all of the participants will get time. And once your presentation is over, you just unmute your audio, but you are requested not to leave the meeting. Because after the presentations are over, the participants are requested to ask few questions. Participants, you are requested to put your questions only in the question answer box and not in the chat box. Okay, so you mention there, and clearly you must mention that your question, you are asking the question to which of the paper presenters, so that we can take off the questions and we can ask each of the presenter regarding the valid questions. Okay, thank you once again. So the first paper presenter will be Professor Ranjana Mishra from SNDT Women's University, Mumbai. So I welcome you, Professor Mishra. So over to you, Professor Ranjana Mishra.
A very warm welcome to all of you. At the outset, I want to congratulate Sister Rashmi and her colleagues for giving us opportunity to enhance our skill at this difficult time of pandemics. I'm reminded of the lines of A.H. Clough, "For while the tide waves vainly breaking, seems here no painful inch to gain, far back through creeks and inlets making, comes flooding silently in the main." In the same manner, we had been abusing climate, nature, and now it has a toll, not only on our health, but on our economy, development, social relationship. The title of my paper is "The Deleterious Social, Economic, and Cultural Ramification of COVID-19 Buddhist Circuit of Bihar." Tourism is one of the most lucrative industries and tourism provides near about 10% of the global revenue and generates near about 10% of the world workforce. Bihar has always been a heritage state, and it has lots of natural beauties, sites, and it has been a melting pot of all major religions, specific fairs, festival, and it has unique gastronomic culture, and that makes it one of the most important hubs of tourism. Like, we have large number of Buddhist circuits in Bihar, and they attract tourists mainly from Nepal, Bhutan, China, Sri Lanka, Japan, Myanmar, Southeast Asian countries. As you can see here, like when last year and before, year before last, I had visited, you can see in the photograph, like even tourists from America, he is Mr. David from America. Then we had large number of people in Rajgir I had met, they were from Myanmar. And then on the right-hand side, you can see Mr. Yuan from China. And then at the end, you can see large number of votive stupas are there, and they are presented by tourists and the pilgrims of different countries. That means we were getting large number in our Buddhist circuit. And tourist industry, it has, like, it is so lucrative that little capital is spent there, but it provides large number of employment, and it multiplies economy, and it is a catalyst to economic and social changes. Environmentalist ever that tourism generates large amount of foreign exchange, and without without polluting the environment. In other industries, like the chimneys are there, effluents, and they leave a carbon footprint. Tourism is the most eco-friendly and is the most lucrative type of business. Buddhist circuit tourism in Bihar covers Bodh Gaya, Nalanda, Vaishali, Kesariya, Lauriya Nandangarh, Rajgir, and Vikramshila. There is decline in the tourism of all these sites because of COVID-19. And especially when I was talking to these people, because it is based on empirical, because I was talking to them telephonically, half of the hotel industries and the business communities, the local people are losing their business by 2018. On an average, according to them, each hotel had about 100 people, and now most of them are unemployed. Regarding the methodology, because of the pandemic, COVID-19, my research paper is based on mixed methodology. Analysis can't be perfect as it is done on random sampling of families and workers. It is based on email questions, telephonic interviews, and discussions. And the second sources are from various reports, articles from Google and other social networking sites, as well as articles and various important books related to the topic. And that helps me in corroborating the hypothesis that negative social, economic, and cultural aspect of tourism is lesser than the positive aspect. And Buddhist circuits of Bihar, as there is paucity of time, so I'll be hurriedly going. We have large number of Buddhist circuits, and the most important is Bodh Gaya, where Buddha had achieved enlightenment. And in 2002, like it was declared as a World Heritage Site. Then we have the next photograph, it is pre-Bodhi. And in that, Buddha has achieved asceticism before achieving enlightenment. In order to have this, the Bihar government has a special train for this Buddhist circuit, and it has been very lucrative. So we have all these centers, as you can see, like apart from Bodh Gaya, there is Shanti Stoop, there is Ropeway, and they generate lots of revenue. And then we have Barabar Hill, then we have Vaishali Dona Stupa, where the mortal ashes of the Buddha was distributed among four disciples. Then you can see my photograph at Kesariya. It has recently been excavated in 1999, and it is supposed to be bigger than Borobudur. And that's why we are finding large number of tourists were there during this time. Then in Kurkihar, when I visited, I found 180 artifacts were there, and there were large number of tourists from outside because all these artifacts are related to Buddha or Bodhisattva. Then Nalanda, Vikramsila, and as you can see, large number of people had been going there. And there was, as per the report of the Indian Government Center Statistics Organization, like Bihar had been getting, the GDP grew by 2010, 11.03, and that was just second to Gujarat, that was 11.05. The benefits was because of this tourism, large number of the respondents, they said that they are getting, they were getting lots of money. And because of that, they could develop schools, roads, handicrafts, industries, souvenirs, shops. And not only that, when year before last, I had visited Nalanda and Rajgir, they have, though it is minuscule, the percentage, but people are into agricultural tourism, and where I had taken the photographs, and they were minting money by converting their homes into hotels, and they where the foreigners were residing in. And according to some of the respondents, this tourism was very, very lucrative and beneficial to them, as it helped them in developing their skill. And even I experienced that, because quite a few of them they were speaking in Japanese and in Chinese language, especially the taxi drivers and the rickshaw pullers, because in order to get more customers. And not only that, they are learning the skills, like they are learning English, then driving skills, as well as like hygiene. And various culinary experts, like that, in order to lure more foreigners, they are learning all these skills. But according to some respondent, it has side effect because the sex trafficking is on high, has escalated because of the foreigners, land grabbing also, pollution, child labor, terror attack, as they are saying, there is a fear. But we had already experienced in 2009-13 in Gaya. And then the working hours had stress on them. the impact of COVID-19 on tourism, one can see that according to them, like this is very, it has got very negative impact because they are not earning anything, and it has been estimated that there is a loss of $1.25 trillion by 2020. CARE has made a study on Bihar and especially on Buddhist circuit, and according to them, like as compared to 2019, there will be decline of 40% of revenue. And
excuse me, ma'am, we are running short of time. Could just wrap up all the presentation.
And so I'll come to the conclusion, because I'm quite positive the revival might be slow, but we are sure once the vaccine is discovered to control this virus, the tourism industry will be the first one to see the major growth. And after a few long time of no travel, people would be looking forward to explore once again new places with lots of care. All the NGOs and the government agencies are now working on reliable analysis and insights to the most up-to-date data and information in order to enact a major and a balanced recovery strategy. This tourism insight will be able to check the extraordinary crisis that we are seeing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Ranjana Mishra, for your empirical observation regarding the Buddhist tourist circuit of Bihar. Thank you. Our next presenter, Dr. Mridula Renu Sinha. I invite Dr. Mridula Renu Sinha to do the next presentation. And the next one in line, Dr. Devjani Sarkar, kindly be prepared for your turn. So over to you, Dr. Mridula Renu Sinha, Head Department of Zoology, Magad Mahila College, Patna University. Over to you, madam.
Good afternoon. This is the title of the paper. As you know, presently, COVID-19 is being contained only through non-pharmaceutical interventions. Non-pharmaceutical interventions include global travel restrictions, social distancing, stay at home, quarantine, and isolation. Due to the non-pharmaceutical intervention, world economy is disrupted, especially the tourism. World tourism is almost ceased since March 2020. This map shows the spread of COVID-19 from Wuhan to the entire world due to movement of infected person from Wuhan. The yellow line shows the airlines routes from Wuhan. On 15 January, there are very few cases, but by 31st March, it became widespread. Bigger the red dots, the higher the number of cases in the country. There are major events during 2000 to 2015, which disrupted the world tourism. Only two of these events, SARS and global economic crisis, led to notable decline in international arrivals, SARS by minus 0.4% and global economic crisis by minus 4%. This is evident from this graph, which shows the growth of air transport passengers and international tourism arrivals from 1995 to 2018. This suggests the world tourism as a system is resilient to external shock. UNWTO estimated on 6th March 2020 that international arrivals would decline by 1 to 30% compared to 2019 due to impact of COVID-19, which was revised very soon on 26th March to a huge decline of 20 to 30%. Due to NPIs, like travel restrictions and SDGs, the global tourism has actually slowed down significantly. For example, Air New Zealand is flying at less than 50% capacity. This map shows country-wise travel restrictions levels. Gray indicates no travel restriction. Yellow, some travel restrictions, and red shows countries close to foreign nationals. Due to COVID-19, the world tourism is almost ceased since last several months, and we do not know when it can be opened fully. Obviously, the present global volume growth model of tourism, which mainly seeks growth in tourism volume, needs serious reconsideration to make it commensurate with the lifestyle changes required. Due to COVID-19 pandemic, we need to learn from this global tragedy to quickly transform tourism to sustainable growth model. Global volume growth model is actually one of the causes of virus outbreaks. Transport, hospitality sector, and industrialized food production pattern act as a medium for repeated distribution of pathogen at regional and global scales. Human interference with wildlife habitat for food and other needs of tourism lead to conversion of wilderness habitat, which is another factor in virus outbreaks. Climate change due to tourism-induced greenhouse gas emissions worsens the risk of pathogen outbreaks due to drought and flooding, etc., leading to human migration and displacement.
And one more minute is left, so we can sum up.
This outline is essential for sustainable growth model of tourism. There is need to align global tourism system, including transport and hospitality sector, to the SDGs and to rationalize the use and redesign the central AC systems. Restrictions on non-veg food sources and on industrialized food production patterns, short-term and long-term behavioral demand response for tourists. Lifestyle to use masks, sanitizer, and other personal protective gears as part of dressing. Critical analysis of need to travel, even local and business travel, and maximizing use of ICTs like tele and video conferencing, including the need to travel, is also required as a part of lifestyle. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam. Thank you, Dr. Mridula Renu Sinha, for bringing up a wide range of effects those are there on the tourism industry after this global pandemic scenario. I now welcome Dr. Debjani Sarkar Ghosh for your presentation. And the next speaker, Dr. Priyanka Sharma, kindly be ready. So over to you, Dr. Debjani Sarkar Ghosh, Head Department of Geography, Patna Women's College.
Good afternoon. My topic is impact of COVID-19 on international tourism. International tourism is the tourism which crosses national boundary. Globalization has made tourism an important leisure activity, and technological revolution has made international tourism easy and affordable. Global pandemic COVID-19, it has made this tourism a halt, total halt. And as per a study, around 96%, right now almost 100% world destination have restricted the movement due to pandemic as a response to the pandemic. The objective of my study is to examine current scenario of the international tourism, to assess inclination of the sample population, to investigate the confidence level of the population, and if confident, the preferred destination of the travel, to examine economic and social problem arise due to the pandemic, and suggestion for survival and revival of the tourism sector. Database secondary data has been collected from different websites, mainly WTO, World Tourism Organization. Primary data has been collected through online survey of 20 to 65 years of population and collected from throughout the world, Indians throughout the world. Data has been tabulated, analyzed with the help of the diagram. Now, what are the current problem of the international tourism? Closure of the international boundary, travel restrictions and lockdown, restriction of the movement of airlines and the cruise ships, closure of the hotels and tourist spots, instruction of the social distancing and limited gathering, still increasing number of the cases of COVID-19 and no vaccine till now. As per World Tourism Organization, it could decline 60 to 80% of the total tourism over the whole year. And it is predicting that 1.1 billion fewer tourism and 100 to 120 billion tourist jobs are at risk. And employment is also in risk, and more than half of this employment is for women employees and women. Now, what are the predictions? If the border opened by June, they are predicting a loss of 58%. If the border opened by September, they are predicting a loss of 70%. And by early December, they are predicting a loss of 78%. And it would badly damage other small and medium sectors, skilled and unskilled labor related to tourism. Now I have done a sample survey of 105 individuals, age group of 20 to 65 years, and it covers students, homemaker, businessmen, and different service holder. Now what are the results? Yes, 72.38% of population agreed suspension of the tour program. They have suspended their tour program. And 63.81% they have agreed this is due to the pandemic problem. And some of them, they have suspended their tour program due to government restriction, because they are sure that yes, when it would be, government will open up the boundary and the border, they might again travel. Now next plan, they are planning, most of them are planning, if they're at all planning, they're planning after December. And some of them, they are not sure, very few percentage, only 6.06% they are planning to travel after June.
But you know, you have to take, that will be from Rosa money, okay?
Okay, international and domestic tourism. You can see that domestic tourism is preferred by this sample population, not the international tourism. And within the country, they are preferring Sikkim, Kerala, and Northeast India, and Jammu and Kashmir. Outside country, they are preferring New Zealand, Vietnam, America, Singapore, and Japan. And they agreed, most of them agreed, yes, tourism is one of the main reasons for the spread of pandemic, so they are not ready to travel in immediate future, but some of them, they didn't agree about it. Most affected sector due to COVID-19, people agreed, yes, tourism and hospitality sector is one of the most affected sector in tourism, due to this COVID-19 pandemic problem. And badly affected, who is badly affected? Most of them, they are telling that, yes, ordinary citizens are badly affected due to this situation. Since they are not, they don't know the problem of industrialists and the government, very few persons, they are perceiving the problem of industrialists or government. Impact of COVID-19 on economy and society, unemployment, closure of business unit, reduction in GDP, and all these problems, they agreed, yes, all these problems are the impact of the economy. And what about society? Social tension due to job loss, number of tourists, less number of tourists, and it might lead to increase in the crime and war and revolution also. So people are facing different type of problem, and they're expecting in the near future, much more social and economic problem will arrive. Now, what's in the conclusion, we can say that tourism industry is currently accounting for 10% of the global GDP. With current pandemic problem, with 150 to 100 million job loss, definitely it would lead to a large-scale unemployment and suicidal situation for owners of the large hotels, aviation sectors, cruise ships, etc. We have already seen suicide of some of the industrialists. Non-utilization of the petroleum, no realization of the tax by government, no business travel or international conference in near future also, not now, in near future, we might expect more Zoom meeting, etc., and the closure of the subsidiary units. Now, what are the suggestions for the survival as well as the revival? What to do to promote international tourism? Borders to open, air travel to start, supply chain to be restored, and with definitely with precaution, and much more cleaning activities. Service delivery boys and girls must be healthy to deliver the service. Government should be ready to market tourist promotion schemes. This is very important. Zero visa fee. Visa fee is very high for international tourism. that must be reduced. Interest-free loans for travel companies, hotel, aviation sector for their survival as well as revival. GST-free holiday. Holidays, GST must be GST-free. License-free, they have to pay a lot of license-free. Electricity fee payment should be allowed to defer. They might be allowed to defer this payment. So once the vaccine and the proper medicine of the COVID-19 will be available, tourism sector, we can expect one of the first sector to recover. Already we can see that China has opened the border. Spain has started tourism with precaution. Some countries have started mutual agreement to start tourism in Australia and Oceania. In some countries, they have started travel bubble. That means they are allowing the countries with the mutual agreement to visit in one another country. So we might expect that with precaution, with better management, we can again restart the international tourism, though it would take a lot of time, might be the next year, but it has to start because it is large number of jobs are at stake. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Devchani, for your illustrative presentation regarding the impact of COVID-19 on international tourism and also the measures for its revival. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon to all of you.
Good afternoon.
So my welcome to the online international conference, that is to Patna Women's College. Now, my topic is impact of COVID-19 pandemic on world tourism, economic and sociocultural aspects. So this is a great challenge today in our day-to-day life of our all human beings. Now, the COVID-19 pandemic is a new infectious respiratory disease emerged in Wuhan, Hubei province, China, and was named by the WHO as COVID-19 coronavirus disease 19. So the first aim to minimize unnecessary negative impact of disease names on your trade, travel, tourism, or animal welfare in the whole world. Now, all of us know about great idea about the concept of epidemic. So, epidemic is a specific health-related behavior, but my topic is, this is the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on world tourism, economic and socio-cultural aspect. So first of all, you go to start. What is the idea of COVID-19? So COVID-19 is a worldwide spread of a new disease with 118,000 cases of COVID-19 having been detected across 110 countries. Then the WHO, the World Health Organization, and which on 11th March 2020 declared to be a pandemic. But in a very short span of time, I'm going to only highlight the main points on my topic. So what is the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on tourism and economy? So first of all, just to say, according to UN, United Nations, WTO, Global Tourism Dashboard, the impact of tourism reflected on loss of 850 million to 1.1 billion international tourists and loss of US dollar 910 billion to US dollar 1.2 trillion in export revenues from tourism and 100 to 120 billion job risks in the whole world. So next is, that is the impact on social as cultural aspects by COVID-19. So that is almost all the nations of the world are struggling to slow down the transmission of the pandemic disease. by testing, restricting large gathering, social distancing, maintaining complete and partial lockdown, making zones like red, orange, green, etc. So, what are the probable solutions to protect the COVID-19? It is a pandemic. So that means I'm giving just few points regarding the self-isolation. Then stay at home does not to work, school, or public places. Another thing is healthy facility, wear a mask. That is compulsory. The government of India has already given instruction to the people of our country. Then keep at least 1 meter distance from other people and do not touch surface with your hands. Then another thing is isolate for 14 days minimum. Even if you are feel healthy in the home when you are coming from the outside, then when you are facing difficulties in breathing, contact your health care provide immediately. But in my last stage, in my conclusion, I'm telling that COVID-19 pandemic is severely affected to the day-to-day life of all human beings in the whole world. But we have learned 3 things from the COVID-19 impact is a pandemic disease. So that means we learn, namely, that is self-isolation, self-quarantine, social distancing. So this is the great impact today in the whole world. Thank you, madam.
Thank you so much, Mr. Behera. Amid this devastating cyclone, you have been able to join from West Bengal. So we
yes,
are
very happy. Severely affected.
I know you are severely affected, as the tourism industry has been affected after COVID. So
thank you so much. Thank you, madam.
Dr. Priyanka, are you ready with your? Are you ready? Will you be able to present?
Good afternoon to all present. So, as we all know that tourism has always been an important contributor in any country's economic growth, but due to the global pandemic, the sector faces many setbacks. So through my further presentation, we will get a slight idea about the consequences faced by the sector. And there is this. An organization called FAITH, Federation of Associations in Indian Tourism and Hospitality, which looks upon the working of various travel and tourism companies. In the recent report, the FAITH has reacted on the various problems faced by the tourist and tourism sector due to the pandemic. Now, this is the main focus of my presentation, that consequences. So Indian tourism after COVID-19, the first is travel and tourism has been adversely affected and is predicted to face a loss up to 25%, which is an indeed a massive loss. Second is the Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises, MSMEs, has resulted that over 95% of its big and small companies are facing the heat due to the lack of cash flows. The next is the pandemic is known to have a larger impact to combined effect of economic desperation at World War II. FAITH has proposed a relief for the sector to all dues seeking postponement payable by the sector. Now some opportunities, as this time when on ground activities are not possible, major travel companies are planning ahead so that whatever there is a slight window open for tourists, they are prepared to grab opportunity and serve the best to their clients. So a positive effect that can be seen as some of the companies looks upon this pandemic as an opportunity to find various new technologies to serve their clients as their there is going to be a great shift in the lifestyles. It may also include low budget and cheap packages to attract a larger portion of the population. And during this pandemic, Indian culture and Indian Ayurveda methods have been adopted by many foreign countries. So at last we have said that this is a pandemic and a very sad period for us, but we are confident that together we can overcome the situation as well. And the recovery might be slow, but we all sure once that we manage to control this virus, the tourism industry will be the first one to see major growth after a very long time. And and I would conclude by saying that we should bring all the precautionary habits which we have learned during this pandemic as a way of life, which in turn will improve standard of living. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Priyanka Sharma from St. Aloysius College, Jabalpur, for coming up with opportunities and possibilities for the revival of very disturbed tourism industry at present. Thank you. So I can see Dr. Shweta Rani joining us from Dayal Singh College, University of Delhi. So over to you, Dr. Shweta Rani, and I request Dr. Bhavna Nigam to be ready for the next presentation. So Dr. Shweta Rani.
Very good afternoon to all the participants and ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Sister M. Rashmi AC, Principal, Patna Women's College, Dr. Amrita Chaudhary, my mentor and my teacher, and all the distinguished dignitaries. And the topic of my discussion entitles Geographical Analysis of Impacts of Pandemic COVID-19 on Tourism Industry in India, a Statistical Inquiry. So let us begin the presentation with a brief introduction of tourism industry in India. We all know that tourism in India has travel and tourism is the largest service industry in India. It is one of the most favored and preferred tourist destination in the world. And for your kind information, it is to be noted that India is probably the only country that offers various categories of tourism with its geographical diversity and rich cultural heritage. This industry provides heritage, cultural, medicinal values, business, and sports tourism. And it is expected that this sector's contribution to country's GDP will grow at a rate of 7.5% yearly in the period 2013 to 2023. Tourism industry in India, at a glance before this pre-COVID-19, it has registered significant growth over the years, rising incomes, the first, increasing affordability, growing aspirations, increasing globalization, and a growing airline industry has supported this industry beyond all fact. Also, improvement in travel-related infrastructure and a better lodging facility at the tourist destinations has been a major factor, which has contributed to the increased foreign tourist arrivals in India. The policy changes in India have played an important role in attracting more and more foreign tourists every year. Now, significance of study definitely forms an important part of a research. And for me, it is three. Tourism holds immense potential for the Indian economy. It can provide impetus to other industries through backward and forward linkages and can contribute significantly to GDP. But in recent time, with the outbreak of COVID-19, this industry has suffered a serious setback. Aims and objectives. There are four major aims and objectives of the present research. The first is to analyze the recent trends in tourism. The second is to study the geographical impact of COVID-19 on tourism industry. Third, to understand the challenges. And fourth, to ascertain the remedies to overcome the strategies for success. And any research is incomplete without the hypothesis. So the hypothesis that I have taken, the sooner we move out of the present pandemic COVID-19 situation, the fast tourist industry in India will flourish and regain its lost glory and losses incurred, thus gaining momentous growth in GDP contribution. Now we have some statistical postulations, and there are a series of statistical analysis to postulate the growth of tourism in India. The first is, this is the pie diagram, which is showing India's travel and tourism industry. And it denotes that personal travel and tourism is the most significant contributor, accounting for 55%. while business travel forms only 9%. Capital investment is also significant with a share of 24%. Hotels, air transport, surface transport, basic infrastructure, and others are some of the other related sectors. This is a bar diagram which is showing the increasing trend of tourism and hospitality contribution to GDP. And the total contribution, it was actually $18 billion in 2006, which raised to $38 billion in 2014, and was projected to reach $71 billion by 2024, which still remains a distant reality. This third stack diagram, or the compound diagram, it shows the increasing trend, and it is showing the constant number of increase in tourist arrivals. And it was expected to reach 1360 million and 1809 million by 2020 and 2030, which is yet to be achieved. Now, let us see the situation of tourism industry during the pandemic COVID-19 situation. And we can see the travel and the tourism industry in India has been a significant contributor to the country's GDP. But the most visible and immediate impact of COVID-19 is seen in tourism sector, in honest geographical segments, inbound, outbound flights, domestic, almost all verticals, leisures, adventures, heritage, meetings, incentives, conferences and exhibitions, cruise and corporate. And the Indian tourism industry is projected to book a revenue loss of ₹1.25 trillion in the calendar 2020, which is the data given by Confederation of Indian Industry in the month April 2020, as a fallout of shutdown of hotels and suspension in flight operations after the onset and spread of the pandemic. This is the proportionate diagram that actually shows the impact of COVID-19 on GDP. And it is shown that India is one of the worst hit nations in terms of value addition to GDP. It came down drastically from 5.3% in 2009, this is the situation of India, to almost 3.6% in April 2020. Now, thus, based on these things, it can be deduced that there exists a very strong and positive correlation between the number of tourist influx in India and their value addition in India's GDP. When this sector was at its peak, its value addition was significantly higher. And at present, this pandemic situation, with the reduction in the number of tourist inflow, the rate of GDP has subsequently come down. So adding to these woes in the months to come will be the fear to travel, whether on business or leisure, as the COVID-19 pandemic wreaks havoc across nations. So, but out of all these grim situations, we definitely have a hope. So amidst the pandemic crisis, there is a ray of hope focusing on some strategies and guidelines. And it includes the first, promotion of local, regional or national tourism. Number second, seasonality strategies and competitive strategies. And such strategies should be developed specifically targeting the seasonal arrival of tourists like the hill stations in summers.
Dr. Shweta Rani, I'm very sorry to interrupt you in between.
Yes.
But since we are running short of time, request you to stick to your observations and sum up your
Okay, fine. And the second strategy is that involves that there should be seasonal arrival of tourists like hill stations in summer or the religious congregation at specific period of time. Also, there should be stiff competition among the stakeholders for reaping maximum benefit. The third strategies that is actually suggested through the research is promotion or event strategies like Kumbh Mahotsav and Magh Mela in Allahabad, Ran of Kutch that we have in Gujarat, and Goa Carnival. The fourth is the pricing strategies, and it definitely involves affordable tourist packages. The fifth is the public relations strategies, including promotional strategies about specific tourist spot to attract the bulk of tourist migrants. And number six is advertising strategies and sales strategies through help of social media, marketing strategies and online platforms via Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, etc. So last, I would like to make a comment that all these new strategies, implementation of the tourism, provided guidelines to focus new development paradigms and approaches to tourism development. Also, such innovations can meet the challenges in the present pandemic situation. So in my final summation, I would like to exhort everyone present in this webinar to have a belief that tourism sector in India will no doubt once again begin to advance, flourish and boom like never before. But at present, we need to keep patience with the long-term strategic plans to achieve sustainable tourism. Together, we have to, we will, and we can come over this global pandemic crisis. And yes, we will travel one day once again. With this, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Shweta Rani, for discussing the current scenario with your statistical analysis and with your strategies for revival. Thank you so much. May I now call upon Dr. Bhavana Nigam. Dr. Bhavana Nigam from AIN College, Patna.
Yes.
So you will be presenting the paper next. And I request Mr. Mrinal Kumar Gogoi and Ms. Mausumi Saiki from Assam University to be ready for the next presentation. So over to you, Dr. Bhavana Nigam.
Thank you, all the organizers of Patna Women's College and all the participants. My topic for presentation is international tourism in India pre and post COVID-19 scenario. So international tourism is basically movement of people from one destination to another in pursuit of recreation, relaxation and pleasure. But it has affected the most vital element of economy is earning and developing reserves of foreign exchange. Now the history of international travel and tourism is quite ancient. We found from the records of Huan Zhang, Ibn Battuta, Marco Polo, Alexander that India has well maintained roads and dharmshalas that led to the interpretation that tourism were of high order in India. Now international tourism comprised of incoming tourism and outgoing tourism. Now the economic impact of international tourism is far reaching. It has multiplier effects leading to taxes, investments, infrastructure, urbanization, thus generating a cumulative growth effect. The tourism also a labor-oriented industry, thus leading to direct and indirect employment and contribution to national income and state revenue as well. It has also far-reaching social and social impacts on tourism, which is act as an instrument for international relations, educating the visitors, improving the social relationships, and improving the infrastructure by the regional group. International tourism in India, if we see the pre-COVID-19 scenario, according to WTTC, tourism generated about 16.91 lakh crore or 9.2% of India's GDP in 2018 and supporting 46.6 million jobs, that is 8.1% of its total employment. If we see India's position in Asia and Pacific, we find out that India ranked 13th out of 140 countries. And they also quote that India has quite good air transport infrastructure along with ground and port infrastructure, high on natural resources and good cultural and business travel conditions. If we see the number of foreigners visiting India, we find that highest percentage share is of Bangladesh, followed by United States of America, UK, Sri Lanka, Canada, Australia, and so on. If we see the estimates of foreign exchange earnings in US dollar million, we find that more than 22 million was earned in the year 2016, which increased to more than 27 million in 2017, and then to more than 28 million in the year 2018, thus bringing lots of foreign money into the country. Now we see the number of foreigners visiting different states. We find that 50 million people alone visited Maharashtra, followed by Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, and Delhi. These states have rich cultural and historic backgrounds, and being the center of economic activities, always attract foreign nationals. With the help of foreign revenue they earned, they have developed good amount of infrastructure facilities, which is needed to attract foreign people. Now, international tourism post-COVID-19 scenario has been changed. According to WTTC, it has cut 15 million jobs globally. Indian tourism and hospitality sector is badly hit, whereas a potential job loss of around 38 million, which is about 70% of the total workforce. The hotel, aviation, and travel sector is also facing a loss of $85 billion, which is felt on both white and blue-collar jobs. Now, airlines being suspended, it has recorded a sharp negative impact, which will follow in 2020. How it's going to affect the aviation sector? Now, aviation sector is going to face a loss of about $113 to $250 billion. A loss of rupees 27,000 crore is expected, and a negative growth of 20 to 25% is also recorded. How it is going to affect the hotels? It is recorded that there is already a revenue loss of rupees 1.25 trillion. Massive spate of cancellation has led to massive downsizing of the staff,
which will further lead to workforce under to work at low wages. How it is going to impact the employment sector? So as far as 9 million jobs are at stake, and which account for 12.75% of the employment in this tourism sector alone. How is going to affect the restaurant industry? So 7 million people are engaged, and nearly 15% of the jobs in the hotel and restaurant industry will be impacted. Now, the restaurant owners are still finding uncertain that how the people going to eat together in this pandemic scenario. Many establishments would close down. So what is the way forward? It has been emphasized that there is a need to potential to tap domestic tourism. The hotel and restaurant industry is seeking relief measures from the state and central government, such as interest-free loans from banks, waiver on all license fees, supply of subsidized food rents, etc. They also expect to restore input tax credit on goods so that they can recover from the loss which is they are facing in the year 2020. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhavna Nigam, for your in-depth presentation regarding the international tourism, its impact and future prospects. Thank you so much. Now I invite Mr. Mrinal Kumar Gogoi and your co-presenter, Ms. Moshami Saikia from the Department of Social Work, Assam University. And I request Dr. Anthomina Robin from St. Aloysius College, Jabalpur, to kindly be ready for your next presentation. So over to you, Mr. Gogoi and Ms. Saikia from Assam.
So good afternoon, everyone. I'm at the very outset. I just want to thank the organizer of this online international conference on COVID-19 pandemic and world tourism, hospitality, trends, challenges, and future prospects. And actually, Ms. Moshami Saikia and myself, I'm Gogoi. So I, both of us actually are not from Assam University. I am working in Mahapurusha Srimad Sankaradeva Vishwavidyalaya, Assam, Guwahati campus, Department of Social Work as head research currently. And Moshami Saikia is a research scholar from Department of Social Work, Assam University. So this is a joint paper, and as because of the time constraints, so I am just taking the charge to present our presentation. So as you can see, the title of the paper is The Impact of COVID-19 Pandemic on Tourists After Lockdown, a study with special reference to tourists within India. So this is an introduction part. An introduction part of this presentation is basically talking about the deadly coronavirus and how it is impacting you somewhere. And it has rise actually at the very outset. But I'm directly going to the tourism part as we are talking about the tourism hospitality sector. So here we are mentioning about the tourism is mentioned to be the natural worrying industry which is $68.29 billion contribution in India 16 to 2019. And which was $247 billion in 2018. And from this point we can also we can highlight that yes, there is a great growth made by the tourism sector, also hospitality sector in the economy of the entire country. So we felt it important to study about the impact of corona pandemic on the tourists after lockdown within India. So as in the statement of the problem, we can see the tourism industry has a strong contribution towards the country's economy, which already I have mentioned, but due to lockdown, the international and the national agencies are unable to operate for which has resulted in great losses. This is happening. And because of this corona pandemic, COVID pandemic, because of this, the economy and even the different sectors, not only the tourism and hospitality sector, different sectors of the country even the growth, they are going to suffer. And because of that, therefore the present study will try to put the gap of research and finding out the use of tourists within the country regarding the future prospects in traveling after lockdown, because it is important for us that what kind of ideas and what kind of mindset the people are taking, especially the travelers, because the traveling industry is completely dependent on the travelers. And we must have to know about their ideas, their plan, and what is there inside their mind. Because of this corona pandemic, there might be different sort of changing in case of their mindset. So we have to know, we have to analyze the issues, what they are exactly thinking. So this study is significant as because we, as again we have to talk about this particular point that tourism industry is one of the rapid growing industry in the world. So definitely there is a very great impact, basically this negative impact on this particular sector. Because of this COVID-19 pandemic, so that is why we need we thought that there is a need of studying about the travelers and their ideas on use of travels after lockdown. So there are two objectives we have set. One is to understand the impact of COVID-19 pandemic and tourist after lockdown in India, and another is to analyze the views of tourists on travel plans within India. So there are certain literature that we did, and skipping this for this moment as because I'm running with scarcity of time. The methodology the universe selected is the tourists from 10 states of India who traveled for the last 2 years. And as to fulfill this objective of the research, participants must have to be in academic, business, or research. So we selected those people who are in academics or who are in business or even any sort of traveling agencies or travel plans, who basically determine sample size. So we have come to this conclusion that especially according to them, this particular pandemic has created a different sort of impact in their lives. And in the second point, you can see, according to most of the respondents, has come to this stressful situation in lives of common people. It has become a pandemic, so it may take time to get into a new normal state. And in the third point, you can see one of the respondents mentioned, like, India will take almost 10 years to regain its economic state. And coronavirus will not get over until ages. This is the statement commonly stated by most of. So these are the views given by different respondents. So like some of the respondents say, they are one of the respondents, yes, I have a plan to travel post-lockdown period only when I am a physical fit, because this should not only affect me, but to the entire travelers. So they have also said, like, I will totally, one of the respondents said, I will totally avoid traveling to Maharashtra and other top 5 states affected by COVID-19. I'm not ready to take the risk, whether it may be any kind of emergency unless medical, said by one respondent. So we are directly quoting their responses like this. Respondent from North East India said that I will try to explore all the North Eastern places first, and then I will prefer taking in the result of the academics. They are also avoiding where the places where many people get together, and because of that also there might be some sort of fear, and there's some different sort of like mindset that may affect them. And in general, they are also not ready to go with their children and the team. So, female partners while traveling. So, there are a lot of issues that are going on in their life. They will also visit less crowded areas. They said, like, they will also visit less crowded areas. So, yeah, because it may have a kind of notion in their mind that there may not be the possibility of getting affected by coronavirus. So, basically, they have also said that they will go with masks, sanitizer, hand wash, towels, and gloves, and also, if possible, they also visit that it will be provided.
Mr. Gogoi, sorry to interrupt. If you could just wind up your presentation.
Okay, ma'am. At the end, I just want to show that in every cloud there is a silver line. And we hope that there will be a normal state. We will get to a normal state one day very soon, as because otherwise it will not be possible for us to continue with this deterioration. And we hope there will be normal life. We will back to the new normal, and otherwise this present coronavirus situation will definitely damage and affect the entire tourism industry. The competent authority and the concerned authority will be taking proper steps so that this industry will grow up once again. Thank you very much once again. Thank you on behalf of both of us.
Thank you, Mr. Gogoi, and your co-presenter, Ms. Saikia. So next presentation will be from Dr. Sanya Pandey and Mr. Shrikant Manvansh from Amity University, Patna. And I request Ms. Sheena Suri. Ms. Sheena Suri, you can be ready for the next presentation. Over to you, Dr. Sanya Pandey.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Good afternoon to everyone. Today, me and my colleague, Mr. Shrikant Manvansh from MIT University, Patna, are together going to present a paper titled as Impact of COVID-19 on Tourism Industry of India in special context to Varanasi. Since both of us have a connection from Varanasi, and we know that Varanasi is one of the most important spiritual and religious tourist spot, not only in India, but across the globe. So that is why we have chosen this topic, And if we talk about coronavirus, we all know that how the virus has affected not only India, but across the world, almost 230 countries. And it has affected all parts of our life, not only social, economic, political, religious, everything, but including tourism also. If we see according to World Trade Organization, international tourism could decline by 60 to 80% in 2020 due to COVID-19 pandemic, which will result to revenue loss of almost $910 billion to $1.2 trillion and placing millions of livelihood at risk. Now, if we talk about India's tourism, India is ranked as the 34th in travel and tourism competitiveness report in 2019, which was published by World Economic Forum. Now, as of 2019, 4.2 crore jobs were created in the tourism sector in India, which was 8.1% of total employment in the country. According to WTTC, India ranked third among 185 countries in terms of travel and tourism total contribution in GDP in 2018. Now, during 2019, foreign tourist arrivals in India stood at 10.89 million, achieving a growth rate of 3.2% year on year. Now, if we see, according to a report published in Business Standards, the Indian tourism industry is projected to book a revenue loss of 1.25 trillion in calendar year 2020 as a fallout of the shutdown of hotels, suspension in flight operations after the onset and spread of coronavirus pandemic. This is a, we try to show through maps that what are the sites here in India from tourism purposes. Now, if we come to Varanasi, a major part of tourism in India is religious and spiritual tourism. It not only attracts people from the country, but outside the world. Varanasi stood one of them. And Varanasi is not only the hub of Hindu religion tradition, religious tradition, but it is also a great center for Buddhist tradition and Jainist tradition. Even there are places for Muslims and for Sikhs as well. There is a famous Muslim mosque which is Gyanwapi, situated near to Kashi Vishwanath Mandir. Now, if we talk about tourism in Varanasi, we have seen that people from across the globe has come to Varanasi. We can see in this picture, we can see Brad Pitt, we can see our Indian actors as well, and some other foreign actors, and see that how freely they used to travel, they used to roam around in the city. There are some of the famous tourist places in Varanasi, not only the temples, because that is one part of the city. We have seen the ghats also, 80 ghats in Varanasi. They are considered as the stage of the city. And in every evening and morning, there are thousands and thousands of programs organizing on these ghats. If we see in Varanasi, people not only from India, but across the globe are coming for several purposes. A major part, if we talk about Holi celebration, which just happened before this COVID-19 attack, there were very few hundred foreign tourists came for Holi celebration. And according to Rahul Mehta, who was the president of Varanasi Tourist Welfare Association, he said in the March that our fear is that the impact will be prolonged. And this is what has happened. Even in the time of Holi celebration, we also went to Varanasi and we have seen very few people, foreign tourists especially, because March is considered to be one of the, March is considered to be a good time to visit the city. But there were very few tourists were there. If we see, this is an annual tourist visit statistic starting from 2015 to 2019 from Uttar Pradesh tourism website, that how many people have visited both Indian and foreign visitors to visit the city. They are very well in number. Now, if we talk about what type of industry it actually exists in Varanasi, tourism industry, apart from religious industry,
Dr. Pandey, you can just sum up.
Okay, okay. So Varanasi has a very important center for death industry also. People wish to come in Varanasi and die. There is, Varanasi is also an educational hub, not only for India, but for people across the globe. Now, if I come to the conclusion part of my presentation, I will say that with the with our Prime Minister's slogan, Jaan Bhi or Jahan Bhi, Varanasi should focus on virtual tourism, which is otherwise also happening with live darshan, with live of Ganga Aarti and all the other things. People from across the globe are able to participate into this. They are even able to participate in Daan Dakshina also virtually. There should be new regulation regarding cleanliness, because the city itself is famous from its dirty atmosphere. So people in Varanasi, tourism industry in Varanasi should also focus on cleanliness. Apart from that, financial support from government is very much required, especially since Varanasi is the constituency of our Prime Minister. So the government should definitely provide some financial support, not only the big industries, but small industries like boat owners and like tourist guide and other small industry people. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sangya Pandey, for presenting the case study of Varanasi and the impact of COVID-19 on the tourism. Thank you so much. The next speaker will be Ms. Sheena Suri from Fairfield Institute of Management and Technology, New Delhi. And I request the next speaker, Dr. Meenakshi Prasad, to be ready. So Ms. Sheena Suri.
A very good afternoon to everybody. I would like to thank Patna Women's College for giving me this opportunity. I don't think of all the miseries, but all the beauty that still remains. To begin with my topic, that is COVID-19, impact of tourism and on the hospitality sector in India and its recovery mechanism. As we all know, the world in this coming to footing with the outbreak of this pandemic, COVID-19, and there is no doubt that it will change the world as we know it. In this time of uncertainty, all the industries are reeling, but it's the tourism and the hospitality sectors that has been hit the most, even all the borders closures, travel restrictions, and lockdown. We know that in India, the holiday seasons begins from April, July, and October till December. But with the pandemic wake havoc across the world, the travel tourism industry has felt the utmost heat. Further, the role of travel and tourism in India, we know that travel and tourism in India has been a significant contributor of the country's GDP. We have seen through the statistics, in around 2018, travel and tourism accounted about 9.2 in the India's GDP and generated about 26.7 million jobs during the last years. The tourism sector accounts for about 12.75% of the employment in India. According to MOT, during the annual report of 2019-20, 87 million of people were employed in the travel sector. Hotels revenue generated about 38,000 crores. This effect is taking us to a very deteriorating state in all time. The effect is seen on account every sector of the society. The job loss accounts about 38 million. According to IATO, estimates hotels, aviations, and travel sectors to suffer a loss of about 85 million. Also, restrictions is imposed on the travel across the foreign borders. Restaurant industries is expected to generate zero revenue with a drop of 50% in the months to come. We see that if this lockdown doesn't remove, in the June 2020, 30% of the hotel and the hospitality industry revenue would be impacted. Moreover, threat remains to the job loss if this doesn't recover. Aviation industry in India could incur a loss of 27,000 crores in 2020-21. Besides all these things going ahead, by staying home today, we can travel tomorrow. There are some of the recovery plans which I would like to suggest and would like to implement. First of all is the monetary support. If stimulus packages are required to smoothen and sustain the sector in the near term, including the supports of funds to be ensured there are no job losses. Also, provide a suspension of 6 to 12 months on the loans, including the worker capital of overdraft. Fiscal supports to be provided for next 12 months, which should exclude taxes on the holidays to travel, tourism, and hospitality sectors. Direct support to revive the demand. Appoint a think tank to evaluate and decide the measures necessary to revitalize all these sectors. Reduce the GST offered by these sectors on these sectors for a period of at least 1 year so that they can recover with this losses. Incentivize travel by introducing a one-time opportunity for travel allowance to be a part of a tax slab. Also, there can be a policy support, that is the annual renewal of the license paid for 2020 should be extended till the end of 2021 without any extra charges. To conclude with this, coronavirus may have brought the pace of travel and tourism to a halt, but it hasn't defeated the spirit of people who are involved in this sector. The blow may seem harsh, but still there is a hope to hope left. Remember, like everything else in our life, this time will too pass. To conclude with this, I would like to say, it won't be like this forever. We will dream today, travel later, plan and execute later. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Suri, for your presentation. Thank you for highlighting especially the recovery plans amid this current pandemic scenario. Thank you. Dr. Meenakshi Prasad, are you there? Dr. Meenakshi Prasad.
I hope yes. I'm audible.
Yes, yes, you're audible. So next presentation will be from Dr. Meenakshi Prasad, Magadh University, Bodh Gaya. And I request Dr. Ritu Narayan to be ready for the next presentation. Over to Meenakshi.
Good afternoon, everyone. The title of my paper is Potential Impact of COVID-19 on Tourism-Based Economy of Bodh Gaya. A Nagar Panchayat situated in Gaya district of Bihar state, Bodh Gaya owes its prominence on the world map to the Mahabodhi temple and the Bodhi tree under which Lord Buddha is believed to have attained enlightenment. It is a very important place of pilgrimage for the followers of Buddhism who come here every year from across the globe, especially from the region of East and Southeast Asia, Tibet and Sri Lanka. It is equally important for Hindus as well, as the last rituals related to Pindadan of Gaya Shrad are performed near the Muchalinda Sarovar within the premises of the Mahabodhi temple complex. Gradually, several other temples and monasteries have been built up here by different countries, which are an added attraction for the visitors. Tourism is the lifeline of the economy of Bodh Gaya, as most of the residents are engaged in the services offered to the tourists. COVID-19 pandemic is having a severe impact on the tourism-based economy of Bodh Gaya at present, and its repercussions are going to be felt in the coming years as well. The present paper is an attempt to evaluate the impact of COVID-19 on the economy of Bodh Gaya. The paper makes a comparison of the author's empirical findings before and during COVID-19 timeline at Bodh Gaya. The methodology used is walking, which is a standard methodology proposed by Pete Geddes to be used in research in several disciplines, especially in geography and tourism. This is a map of the study area. Here we have a brief geographical profile of Bodh Gaya. Bodh Gaya offers the following avenues of employment to its people: hotel industry, renting of private houses to tourists, restaurants and roadside eatery joints, transport sector, registered shops and emporiums selling every day as well as gift items for tourists, makeshift shops on pavement selling groceries, bedding items, utensils, small domestic electrical appliances, green groceries, drinkless for tourists, work as tourist guide and travel agent, photography for tourists, selling of offerings like incense, flowers, sweets to the tourists, work as sanitation workers and the banking sector. All of these avenues are related to tourism sector. The pre-COVID-19 walking experience could be summed up in the following points. The place was bustling with life. It was difficult to work due to heavy pedestrian traffic, as well as two-wheelers flying on the main road. The movement of auto rickshaws, cars and buses was restricted till noon one, after which only e-rickshaws were allowed on the road. Hotels and restaurants, as well as roadside eatery joints, were buzzing with people. A large number of registered shops and emporiums were open for service. A large number of pavement shops and carts were also working. A large number of foreigners were observed on the road. The second major portion of the tourist population was observed to be of people from southern India. Worshipping items were being sold outside the Mahabodhi temple complex. Some guides were seen approaching the tourists to offer their services. Now, walking experience during COVID-19 situation. The hotels and restaurants and roadside eatery joints are closed. It's very easy to walk as the road is deserted. Makeshift shops on the pavements are closed. E-rickshaws and auto-rickshaws are a rare sight. Registered shops and emporiums are closed. Only those selling grocery items are open for 2 hours every day during morning and evening. Only the local faces can be seen. The foreign faces have become rare. Mahabodhi Temple and other monasteries and temples are temporarily closed for the public at present. It has a deserted look. These are some pictures comparing the pre-COVID scenario and the post-COVID scenario. The bulk of the envelope analysis is that the economy of Goa Gaya has been brought to a standstill situation during the COVID-19 and the lockdown implemented due to it. There are no jobs, save for some essential services such as the grocery shop owners, workers of petrol pump, and chemist shop owners at the moment. Vast majority of the tourists have already left the place. Many bookings were cancelled even before the lockdown when the corona scare first came into light. Since 18th of May, 6 special flights carrying unarrived from UK and Middle East have arrived in Goa Gaya, and now the hotels have been turned into a quarantine centre for them on a paid basis. So now hotels have opened, but they are functioning on a skeleton staff, and once the lockdown is over, their situation is not very optimistic. Also, the threat of COVID-19 spread is looming over the head of the local population. The people are in despair due to unemployment and loss of livelihood. It may be expected that it will be only after another year or two that the tourists, both foreign and Indian, will think about traveling to Goa Gaya. But they will definitely think twice about their trip as this place has been turned into a quarantine center and the scare of COVID-19 has been deeply etched in the minds of the people. Till then, what will happen to the economy based on tourism and what will be the condition of the people engaged in this economy of Goa Gaya is a looming question. The true impact assessment is not possible without the end of COVID-19. The future scope of the study continues will involve the estimation of fall in income, the estimation of fall in employment opportunities, and the estimation of fall in hospitality sector. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Meenakshi, for a very high-speed presentation regarding the tourism-based economy at this post-COVID scenario at Goa Gaya. Thank you. Ms. Shikha Verma is with us. Ms. Shikha Verma from the Fairfield Institute of Management and Technology, New Delhi. Over to you, Ms. Shikha Verma.
Thank you so much, ma'am. First of all, I want to inform that due to some impromptu system issue, I'm unable to switch on my video presentation and therefore presenting my topic via audio live. So to begin with, my greetings to one and all here. I am Shikha Verma, Assistant Professor from New Delhi. Today with this presentation, I'm going to briefly summarize you all with my topic, that is interrupted tourism and economic depression during COVID-19 outbreak. In the era of globalization, fast networking and communication has made the world shrink day by day. For any country to develop, inflow of income from different sources is must. Travel and tourism have been a prominent sector for economic development and job creation throughout the world. Despite our fastest growing sector, it is considered as highly vulnerable sector too, that gets impacted with different disturbances within the nation or outside the nation. In this era of pandemic due to outbreak of COVID-19, the entire national and international policies have got impacted manifold. Tourism sector has got the toughest hits. The sector has experienced and is experiencing a rapid and sharp drop in demand and billowing of job losses at global level, especially many SMEs at risk. The hotel and tourism sector in all its geographical locations, domestics, international, and almost all type of leisures, adventure, religious, social, heritage, meetings, incentives, conferences and exhibitions, crews and corporates have got derailed presently and for indefinite future. Due to the travel restriction, there is huge slump in demand among travelers. According to the World Travel and Tourism Council, that we call WWTC, forecast that up to 75 million people jobs are at risk in this sector. As tourism is a vast umbrella, sheltering hotels, aviation sector, local and interstate transports, regional markets, crafts and food market, the effect of downfall of tourism is deeper, as we know that tourism is one of the major job creators for many, that include a higher share of low-skilled immigrants, women and students who are employed in tourism, the shutters of many sectors affecting different strata of global societies. The reports of Ministry of Civil Aviation has stated that India is witnessing a 25% to 30% drop in inbound international visitors to the country in the backdrop of novel coronavirus fears. In order to control the spread of this virus among masses, Government of India, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has issued many travel advisories covering vast areas like international commercial passenger aircraft, prohibition of passenger from different countries, expanding compulsory quarantine for a minimum period of 14 days for passengers coming from or transiting through foreign countries, suspension of visas, except a few officials which are mandatory for the national development. These all precautionary measures are definitely with the aim to block the spread of this fatal virus. But along with this, it has already created a cascading effect on Indian tourism and hospitality. In the report of ICC, that is Indian Chamber of Commerce, it was stated that the hospitality sector have seen 50% drops in bookings within India in early weeks of March 2020. In this paper, I have tried to put in impact of this lockdown at multiple periods, especially in India. The aim of this paper is to study the impact of COVID-19.
Ms. Shikha Verma, kindly conclude.
Yes, ma'am. About to. Yes. So there's no denying fact that to reestablish the Indian economy and the global economy, a strong planning and policies have to be created, considering the needs of each stratum. The entire policy system has to be considered needs rebooting to re-uplift the economy from the base. Therefore, with much deeper enlightenment of the impact of COVID-19 in GDP and in personal disposable income of each tourism-related individual, it is hoped that government will come up with efficient policies to pull out this industry from financial quicksand, and we will re-establish the theme of Incredible India and flourishing tourism sector in near future. With this, I end my presentation and extend my thanks to Patna Women's College for organizing this online international conference, and to all the participants for their valuable contribution. Thank you so much. Namaskar.
Thank you, Ms. Shikha Verma, for your presentation, rather your observations regarding the various aspects of post-COVID scenario and tourism industry. Yeah, so yours is the last presentation of this session. So I invite Dr. Ritu Narayan from Ellen Mishra Institute of Economic Development and Social Change, Patna. So over to you, Dr. Ritu.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon to all eminent speakers, participants of this virtual audience of this conference. I, Ritu Narayan from Ellen Mishra Institute, Patna, would like to present a paper on impact on tourist behavior pattern tourists during and after lockdown. The coronavirus pandemic has devastated the tourism industry as countries seal their borders and billions of people stay at home. Nevertheless, it has engulfed almost the whole globe. Almost 38 billion people lost their jobs out of 55 million people working in the tourism industry. 10 million are more likely to lose. I wish these kind of conferences act as revival for this sector. My paper deals with analysis of prospective tourists, change in their behavioral pattern, their perception towards choice of destination, attitudinal transformation, and future prospects of tourism industry. Inputs were also derived from hospitality sector and government officials. my objectives are to have an insight about the tourist behavioral pattern, to know the future prospects of tourism in India and abroad, to know the attitudinal change with respect to preference of tourism, to know the impact of social distancing and sanitization among the tourists, to know about the frequency of traveling among the tourist persons. I conducted a research by using both primary and secondary data. By random sampling method, respondents were selected from different countries, different age groups, different occupations, and different income groups. A questionnaire was prepared comprising of different sections, and virtual responses were recorded. I received 104 responses. Also, telephonic interview was conducted from respondents in the hospitality sector and government officials. Secondary data was mainly collected from newspapers and websites. According to the responses received, some of the analysis of the questions are shown below. Some of the findings which I got from the primary as well as secondary research are risk-taking. Tourists in the age group of 35 to 50 years who have established families are less likely to take risk. They are also not ready to travel in the peak season. Choice of destination. Tourists post-lockdown have shown more interest in going to mountain sites and beaches rather than pilgrim sites. Domestic versus international tourism. Preferences of tourists changed from domestic to international, to domestic sports more in comparison to international ones. Income status. High income group were ready to pay premiums for better services and were conscious about social distancing and sanitization, whereas the low income group preferred to stay back at their homes. Certain suggestions are mentioned. For example, social distancing, sanitization, and thermal screening should be mandatory in future. Lesser known tourist spots need to be revived and developed. To note down, if we take the example of Bihar, for example, the monolithic Ashokan pillar at Vaishali and migratory bird sites at Begusarai are some of the lesser known spots which many of us don't know, and even we need to attract the national as well as the international tourists there. Places of worship should follow government norms strictly throughout the year because they invite the many more tourists from all around the world. Initiation of virtual tours. We can also develop virtual tours of our rich cultural heritage depicted by historical spots, museums, art galleries, places of worship for business purposes. Travel bubbles. This is initiated by allowing movement within a group of a specific nation. These travel bubbles we can now see in New Zealand and Australia, as well as in some of the European countries. To sum up, we can conclude that definitely we can say that tourism behavioral pattern has undergone a massive change. Perception has changed from mixing with people to staying away from people. Nobody wants to interact with strangers. They are unable to read their facial expression, which is hidden under the mask. Amid so many adversities, still, we as tourists, as citizens, need to find better ways to overcome these attitudinal and perceptual change in tourist behavior. Thank you all for listening me patiently. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Ritu Narayan, for your presentation based on the empirical study. Thank you very much. Now it is time for a very short question answer session. So I hope all the paper presenters are there. You can put your video on, all the paper presenters, you and the panelists, you are requested to put your video on. We'll have a very short question answer session. Dr. Devjani, you are there. So the first question is to you. What should be the government initiative to resume the international tourism the earliest? And do you think the international tourism can regain the same status in future as it was before the pandemic period?
That is the question. I can how to resume the tourism, isn't it? I can see the question.
No, actually two questions are joined together. First is, what should be the government initiative to resume the international tourism the earliest? And second is, do you think the international tourism can regain the same status in future as it was before the pandemic period?
Yes, in the, for the first section, I can say that yes, government can take some initiative to revive international tourism, because that's their, for their gain also, because they used to earn a lot due to international tourism. First thing is that there should be proper medical screening and medical certificate should be provided to the tourists who are intended to travel, say for New Zealand and Australia, or maybe some Nordic countries where they are allowing the international tourists, like Spain is allowing the international tourists. So first thing that the government of India should do, they should definitely provide medical certificate to give them certificate, just like Aadhaar card, one of the speaker told that yes, he is free from coronavirus, he has not suffered, and he's free to travel. So that is one thing that government should provide. And another thing government should do, that they must reduce the visa fee and give some allowance for the travel. If they travel internationally, that amount may be reduced from the total income. That would be a very good initiative from the government. Then people would be ready to travel. And what's the second question?
The second question, can international tourism regain its present status?
No, it's very difficult. At least for not in this year. We can expect next year it might regain, 2021. Because in my survey also have seen that no one is, very few persons are ready to travel this year. All of them are interested to travel next year. And some of them, they are deferring their plan also. So very less chance for survival of international tourism this year.
It may regain, but it will take time.
It will take time. Definitely okay. It will take time.
Okay? Thank you.
Anything else?
Thank you. Next question is for Dr. Shweta Rani. You can unmute. Yes. The question is, will the hosting of Kumbh Mela and other such huge social gatherings be feasible in near future, considering the social distancing norm?
Thank you so much, Amrita ma'am. Not at all. I think you have missed, I have written a line in my presentation that all these strategies that I'm mentioning should be followed only when we overcome the present crisis and pandemic situation, or when the present pandemic situation comes under control. So for your kind information, all these religious congregation or the seasonal tourism is one of the important source of revenue generation for Indian tourism. So once the present situation of COVID-19 comes under control, we can think in this respect, but definitely there has to be certain restriction. Now, what are these restrictions? There should be proper management by the local authority, be it in whichever city. There should be city management system and city planning. And yes, there should be strict government control over the number of people gathering at one particular place. So if all these things are taken into consideration, and once the situation of present pandemic comes under control, maybe after 1 year, then we can think in this respect. Any more questions?
I have one question. Airlines is not cooperating. One person has mentioned that he has booked for ticket and didn't get any refund. and how do we repose faith in the airlines when they are not cooperative? Yes, we have to keep some faith. We can hope, yes, they will definitely cooperate. And you can reschedule your program. What else we can expect? It's a time to adjust for everyone. Even the airlines are on the they are running at a very loss, so they can't repay right now. What I can say, it's very difficult for them to repay. So please try to adjust and reschedule your program.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Sangya Pandey, one question for you. Dr. Sangya Pandey, are you there? She's not there. There is a question for Professor Ranjana Mishra. Professor Ranjana Mishra, you can unmute your audio. Yeah, question is that will the long-term social distancing affect the Buddhist circuit tourism of Bihar?
It will, because for 1 year, that is the prediction, that is the anticipation. Like, people have lost so much, they won't be able to, and it is going to affect the Buddhist circuit, because most of the people, like majority of them, were foreigners from Southeast Asia, from Bhutan, from Nepal, where COVID has infected them a lot. So foreign tourists, we are not going to get for 1 year. So it is going to affect the revenue.
Okay, thank you, madam. So with this, we have come to the end of the first day of this online international conference. Now, I request all of you to just switch on your video so that we can capture this moment. Yeah, thank you. So few informations. First of all the paper presenters will be receiving the certificates, so after a gap of 1 week. And secondly, tomorrow we will begin our session at 11 o'clock. We'll have plenary sessions, and then we'll have a technical session. So all those who will be presenting papers tomorrow, kindly limit your presentations to 5 minutes only. Make your presentation very crisp and short, because technical session will be followed by the closing valedictory session. So we need to wind up the technical session on time. So we need this kind of cooperation from you. So with this, goodbye and good day. We'll see you once again tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you, Amrita. Thank you for very good conducting the session.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amrita ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Amrita Chaudhary.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you.